In the football-crazed state of Florida, Tampa Bay belongs to the Bulls. Their fan base, even their former quarterback Matt Grothy, energized by a charismatic new leader in Skip Holtz, who brings championship experience to a USF program ready to charge into a new decade. The wait is over. 2010 college football has arrived. The Bulls are back. Raymond James on a Saturday night where the Bulls are undefeated in home openers in their 13-year history. The first ever meeting with the Stony Brook Seawolves, the reigning co-champs out of the Big South, representing football's championship subdivision. Good evening, everyone. I'm JB Long. Sincerely thrilled to be with you, not just for a new season, but for a new era of USF football. Skip Holtz arrived in Tampa in January, saying he was here to win championships, and he went right to work, winning the trust of his current players, recruiting the future of the program. He's embraced the media and his role as an ambassador for the university. Safe to say he shook at least one hand for every yard his Bulls hope to gain this fall. And in college football, that's half the job description. But tonight, he'll try to make an equally positive first impression on the field as he enters his 11th season as a head coach, and his biggest luxury, having an established dual-threat quarterback to work with. And tonight I can say the same thing. Our Sean King, one of the most efficient quarterbacks in NCAA history, and after his career at Tulane, spent several successful seasons on the field behind us as a quarterback for the Tampa Bay Buccaneers. So Sean, as BJ Daniels enters his first season, full season as a starter, how is he different than a year ago?
You know, I think when you think BJ Daniels last season, one word comes to mind: explosive. Explosive athleticism, explosive big time arm. This offseason, he's learned how to channel his superhero, as I call it. To be a successful quarterback, you not only have to be Superman, you have to be Clark Kent. He's learned how to take the check down when necessary, throw the ball away when that's appropriate. I think he's poised for a breakout campaign.
Finding targets to throw to may prove to be a challenge, though, after losing three of his top five receivers from 2009. Carlton Mitchell opting for the NFL. A.J. Love suffered a knee injury in the final minutes of the spring game. And Sterling Griffin went down with an ankle early in offseason conditioning. They hope to have the latter two back, but Dontavia Bogan has to step up in the meantime.
You know, the great thing about people not being here, who you're accustomed to seeing, is it's an opportunity for new guys to emerge and explode onto the national scene. Dontavia Bogan's been waiting for this opportunity his whole life. It's time for him to grasp it and take advantage of it.
After the most successful NFL draft in program history, several holes to fill on the defensive side of the ball as well. And defensive end Craig Marshall will have his chance to fill the extremely large shoes left by Jason Pierre-Paul and George Selvey.
You know, they were completely dominant defensively. You didn't mention Nate Allen, Jerome Murphy, also parts of that defense that have moved on. Craig Marshall has to step up and make plays, but he's not alone. Terrell McClain, Quentin Washington, Skinny Marshall, Jarrell Young. It's a bunch of names that nobody knows, and those guys are just itching to become first-team All-Big East, first-team All-American.
Their new defensive coordinator is Mark Snyder, and his task starts tonight with containing Stony Brook's potent rushing attack, and that all starts with Eddie Gowans.
You know, Eddie Gowans is a guy a lot of people may not know, but he's a very impressive running back, has great acceleration through the hole, also is great in space. So this Bulls defense is going to have to do a good job of fundamental tackling when it comes to getting Edwin Gowans to the ground.
Sean, we've been talking for 8 months. It's time to finally play some football. Stony Brook, USF, kickoff next on Bright House Sports Network. And welcome back to Tampa. JB Long, Sean King, moments away from kickoff between the USF Bulls and the Stony Brook Seawolves. Time to meet the third member of our team. Victoria Lim joins us from the sideline. And we'll come back upstairs and join Victoria in just a moment. We can tell you that the USF captains did exactly what was asked of them. They went out and won the first coin toss of the year. Samson Genis, Jaquan Williams, Mr. Raymond, and Armando Sanchez. The Bulls will defer, as Coach told us they would.
You know, he feels that if you can go out and get a three and out, that you can regain that field position. But Coach Holtz just feel like the second half is when the game's won, so he'd rather receive the ball coming out of the locker room after halftime.
Everybody, So the Bulls set to kick it off. Mykon Bonani, the sophomore from Lake Wales, Florida, will put a foot into it. Deep to receive for the Stony Brook Seawolves. Their specialist, led by the transfer, Brock Jakulski, with his heels on the goal line. Bonani boots it away, and the Skip Holtz era is underway in Tampa. Jakulski from the 10 across the 20, and he is met there by Joyce, the freshman at the 25, driven back, and the Seawolves will take over from there. Well, Joyce getting on the field in his first collegiate kick, makes the tackle. And so the Stony Brook offense, led by Michael Coulter, 6'1", 210, and a junior, led the conference in touchdown passes with 15 in 2009, completing 55% of his passes.
And JB, it'll be interesting to see, has the strength of this defense remained, although they've had to deal with the departure of George Selvey and Jason Pierre-Paul. South Florida defense has always been known for getting pressure on the quarterback.
And just like that, Stony Brook has to take a timeout, perhaps not used to this atmosphere. In fact, we're sure they've never seen a stadium or a crowd like this. This is their first opponent from the Bull subdivision.
You know, this is a big game for Stony Brook. This is a game that they've had circled, beginning off-season workouts, throughout off-season workouts, going into training camp. They've looked at this as an opportunity to present their program to America. So there have to be a little jitters, you know, not only with the players, but on the coaching staff as well.
Tight formation and four down linemen for the Bulls. Some shifting in the Seawolves' backfield. The first carry is to Gowans, and he is met behind the line of scrimmage and dropped. Bedford made the tackle. He spun it loose. They'll rule him down, but a good defensive play to start for the Bulls.
And the thing you see right now, they are excited to be a part of this new era. Skip Holtz has these guys flying to the football. One thing you look for in defense, how many defensive guys end up at the ball carry? Almost the entire 11 ended up on Edwin Gome.
Just a fullback in the backfield now with Coulter under center. Again, they'll shift Gallons back seven steps deep. Play action, the bootleg near side. It's complete out near the 30. Tackle made there by D.D. Lattimore. And we'll take a look at the Stony Brook offense. We've introduced you to the quarterback, Coulter. Paul Fenaroli leads the show up front, a first-team All-Big South center and the team captain. Chuck Priore calls Michael Coulter a technician, and he'll work with Eddie Gowans. He'll get the bulk of the carries. Matt Brevi, a Tampa native, a wide receiver, injured a knee this week, so we'll see Jordan Gush, Mike Lepore, and the tight end Brett Arce, the primary pass catchers for the Seawolves. Six on the play clock. Again, some confusion at the line. Dealing with the crowd early are the Seawolves. It looked like someone jumped, and there will be a flag. They'll catch Brett Arce.
Ball start, 84 offense, 5-yard penalty, third down.
So that'll set up third and 10, and you don't want to be playing at or behind the chains on the road.
Especially against a defense that's excited, they're amped up, they're ramped up. You know, sometimes you can, you know, out-scheme yourself. You know, Stony Brook's done a lot of movement on the first couple of plays, you know, had to call a timeout, have a false start. That's not the beginning that you envision when you come and play a team like South Florida.
Skip Holtz said he wanted to defer, as he always does, but especially because he has confidence in this defense to get a three and out and change the field position early. They'll drop Coulter into the shotgun on third and 10. They'll hand it off to Gowans, running left side. The corner's up to make the play. Again, a tackle for a loss. Mistral Raymond, the senior, makes the tackle, and the Seawolves will have to punt.
And if you Skip Holtz, you understand that the one thing that you do have on defense is sideline to sideline speed. So Stony Brook, if they want to attack this defense running the football, they're going to have to find a way to go north and south. South Florida's as fast as anybody in the country from sideline to sideline.
Get a look there at the former walk-on, Raymond. Terrific story for the Bulls and a starting job as they moved him from safety to corner in camp. Farron Horns deep to receive the punt. Drew Evangelista takes the snap and sends it away. A short, wobbly spiral fielded at the 45 and dropped. Farron Horns does recover, and the Bulls will maintain possession But early in the season, and especially early in the game, some special teams trouble for the Bulls.
The jitters probably on both sides.
And so we do get a look at B.J. Daniels. He leads the USF offense out onto the field. Starting for his first season, he did get significant playing time, taking over in week three after Matt Grothy was injured against the game against Charleston Southern. So Daniels, 6'1", 212, the sophomore out of Tallahassee. Bradley battles, gets the start in the backfield. They'll swing it out wide to Bogan. Get an early touch, and he breaks away. Dontavia Bogan on the first play from scrimmage. Touchdown! Yards, the first score. The Skip Holtz era goes to Dontavia Bogan.
And a great job by B.J. Daniels. You just talked about him. He's matured into the leader of this offense. He now has the freedom, if he sees, this is a call run, JB. He sees more than enough guys in the box defensively where they cannot block the people in the box. Throws a great pass to Dontavia Bogan. Bogan, I told you, young guys an opportunity to emerge on the scene. Catches it, makes his guy miss. Touchdown, USF.
Eric Schwartz on to boot it through. So one offensive snap is all it took for the Skip Holtz era to get underway in grand fashion. 7 points on the board for the Bulls. We'll get another look at the touchdown from Dontavia Bogan as we take our first break. B.J. Daniels to number 81 down the sideline, and we're off to the races in Tampa. We welcome you back to Tampa, and we welcome our Orlando audience joining us after Jacksonville State upsets Ole Miss 49-48 in double overtime. Let's go back down to the sideline and meet the third member of our team, Victoria Lim, with more on the coaches.
Hi, JB. Hi, Sean. Hello, BHSN audience. Coaches Priore and Holtz have a similarity, a distinction in common. Both are the second coaches in their program's history. But while Priore has been on the job for about 5 years, and Holtz kind of sees that as an advantage because he has tape to watch of that team and that coach. But for Priore, this is the first time he's getting a chance to look at USF. Back to you guys.
Stony Brook on the return here again. It's Jokolski brought down just past the 20, and Stony Brook had never seen anything the likes of Dontavia Bogan on that wide receiver screen. He goes 59 yards on the first play of scrimmage for the USF Bulls, and we'll get a look at Chuck Priore. Brought his team in here with very realistic expectations. Says, we know USF is better than us. We want to come in and play fundamental, well-coached football and wait for the Bulls to make their mistakes if they do in their new systems.
And the famous words of Mike Tyson, everyone has a plan until they get hit. You know, that sounds good. But the way USF is flying around to the ball, you're going to have to at some point probably get creative to try and generate some offense.
So Coulter from the 26. Again, the give is to Gowans. He picks up three before he's brought down by the pile there in the middle of the USF defense. D.D. Lattimore credited with the tackle. And take a look at the USF defense. Bedford, McLean, and Marshall are the seniors up front. Porkchop, Corey Grissom, the sophomore at tackle. Ryan Giddens will not play with a foot injury up front. Williams, Lattimore, and Linares, the backers, will see Sabbath Joseph in there as well. Young and Legist, the safeties. Washington and Raymond at corner. We've already seen Mistral make a tackle. Webster will be the nickel back.
You know, I love that nickname. That's such a fitting nickname for a D tackle. Porkchop Corey Grissom.
Second and 7, just inside the 25-yard line. Gowans finds running room up the middle. Young there to make the tackle, but not before they move the chains for the first time tonight.
And at the end of their last possession, JB, you remember I mentioned, you know, it's very difficult on a defense that has as much speed as South Florida to run east and west, sideline to sideline. It seems as though Coach Priore has come and made that, you know, subtle adjustment and seems to be trying to generate a ground attack rushing north and south, which if this defense has a weakness, I don't know how stout they are at the defensive tackle position.
To that big defensive line for the Bulls. They've owned the line of scrimmage so far. Play action to Gowans. Coulter wants to throw over the middle, looking for Lepore. It's knocked away by Raymond. Mistral Raymond, 6'2", a senior from Palmetto. They call him Skinny.
And this is an outstanding play. You know, a lot of cornerbacks don't have the composure to wait for the ball to arrive. A lot of them act too quickly and get a pass interference. Outstanding job timing, you know, the pass breakup, with the football arriving. They are so excited about the progress of Mr. Raymond. Thinks he's going to have a really productive year replacing Jerome Murphy, who left to go to the National Football League.
You saw those long arms there. Part of the reason they moved him from safety to corner, they feel his body type fits that position perfectly. Back to the ground. It's Miguel Masonette checking in the ball game for the first time and getting his first carry. Picks up a big chunk, call it seven. That'll set up third down and about three.
And this is what I wanted to see for this USF defense. Can they stop a physical rushing attack? You look around the Big East Conference, Deion Lewis at Pittsburgh. Rutgers likes to run the football north and south. They're going to have to prove that they can stop people from running between the guards.
Coulter goes no huddle here. The three receivers. Masonette is back. Eight on the play clock now. Third and a long three. The defense jumps for the Bulls. Could be a free play for Coulter. He throws out wide and incomplete. I do not see a flag. I believe the Bulls got back on side. And so the Seawolves will punt for the second time tonight.
Good job of voice inflection, you know, by Michael Coulter. You know, a lot of times, you know, people forget that colleges don't get preseason games. You know, all they've done is practice against each other. As the season progresses, that center will learn, you know, when the guy jumps on the hard count, go ahead and snap the football so that you guarantee you get the offside.
Special teams has been a point of emphasis for USF. It has not been their strong suit in recent years. Farron Horns deep to receive the punt. He bobbled the first and nearly juggles another one here. Does break free at the 25. Now across the 30, and the ball comes loose. Evan Landy dove on it from behind. Jakulski says he has it for USF, for the Stony Brook Seawolves. We'll see what comes out from the pile. They do have it. So Farron Horns fields two punts, the second one put on the ground. And Stony Brook creates an early turnover.
And Farron Horns is a senior, so he understands, you know, how important ball security is. You know, he's a guy that's trying to make a play. He's trying to establish himself as a viable option on special teams. But in doing that, you have to make sure that you take care of the football.
Big change of field position now. Seawolves at the 35.
The ruling on the prior play is under further review.
And so they will go to the replay booth to see if Farron Horns was still live with the carry when he put it on the ground. Sean, what did you see there? Looked like a clean fumble.
Well, it was difficult to tell from the replay that I witnessed. You know, but the replay officials came in before the game. They said that the coaches this year in college football do not have to request a replay or review of a play for it to go up to the booth. If they see something that they feel might be questionable, then they have, you know, the authority to ask the head official to come to the sideline. Let's take a second look.
Horns clearly won the starting kick return, punt return duty, and that is an obvious fumble. Evan Landy there alertly tried to dive on it, but he got the wrong end of a Seawolf and was squeezed out from the play.
And I don't think this one will take long because that hit, unfortunately, you know, for South Florida, his knees were not even close to the ground. And a lot of, you know, punt returners, kickoff returners, they make the mistake. You know, you've done a good job. You've made a couple people miss. You're in a lot of traffic. You have to become very aware of ball security. You have to maintain possession of that football. That is the most.
After further review, the play stands as called on the field. Stony Brook ball, first down.
You know, JB, that's the most valuable commodity on the field is the football. You can't do anything without it.
Started to say that Horns won the job, returning punts coming out of camp. He is the only punt returner listed on our game day two deep. Dontavia Bogan and Lindsey Lamar are also some kick return alternatives, but they're trying to limit the special teams touches for Bogan because they are so thin at wide receiver. They want to keep him healthy as best they can. Change of field possession here. They go to Gowans. Gowans dances in the backfield, loses his lid, and still piles forward out to about the 32-yard line. Gain of three on the play.
A real strong, physical run by Edwin Gowans. He's not intimidated by this Big East defense of South Florida. You know, here's a guy who has, you know, 2,000 career yards and 20 touchdowns. So he's carried the football a lot. You know, that's just unbelievable. Helmet comes off still, keeps moving forward. If I lose my helmet, I'm getting down.
They did mark him down at the 34, so only a gain of one. Now Coulter from the shotgun. A pump and go to the end zone, looking that way, and has Lepore out of bounds inside the five. A big pickup, excuse me, that's Gush, Jordan Gush. Well, you saw the pump fake from the quarterback, Sean.
And this is a fake screen pass. A lot of teams like to run this screen pass, and they release the receiver to block the safety. This time they fake the screen pass. Good throw by Couture up the sideline. Jarrell Young just a little late getting over the top for South Florida.
First and goal from the three. The fullback, Schwicky, to the left of the quarterback, Coulter. They give it to Gowans, working left side, and he piles into the end zone. Touchdown, Gowans. Touchdown, Seawolves. So Stony Brook capitalizes on the momentum change created by the fumble.
And that's why ball security, possession of the football is of such importance. Here you are, your defense has done their job, gotten Stony Brook off the field. You get an opportunity to get the football back and go up potentially two scores. You fumble that punt, and now Stony Brook gets momentum. And as evidenced by Jacksonville State being Ole Miss today, anything can happen.
PAT is up and through. We'll take another look at the touchdown. It looked like it might be easy tonight in Tampa for the Bulls after they scored on their first offensive play, but Stony Brook answers back. USF football on Bright House Sports Network is brought to you by Tampa General Hospital, Verizon Wireless, and by CGM Services. And welcome back to Raymond James Stadium in Tampa. J.B. Long, Sean King, we're tied at 7 midway through the first quarter of play. Stony Brook capitalizing on a fumbled punt by the Bulls, and they will kick off here with Dontavia Bogan deep to receive for the Bulls. Short kick by the Wolves. Richard Kelly and Andreas Shields, the up men, take it, and they fall at the 30. So decent field position for the Bulls in the second drive for B.J. Daniels. They scored so quickly on their first possession, we didn't have a chance to introduce the USF offense, led by the captain, Samson Genis, makes his 18th career start, anchors a front five that now has over 120 combined games of experience. The combination of Bradley Battles and Mo Plancher in the backfield.
Number 83 on the kicking team, 5-yard penalty, re-kick.
As you heard there, we will re-kick. Just to finish that thought, the backfield with Daniels, Bradley Battles, and Mo Plancher, who's been slowed by a shoulder injury. And we'll introduce you to the rest of the Bulls offense after this re-kick. You know, special teams is something that I know all the coaching staffs stress in camp, but you have so many things to get to preparing for a new season that sometimes special teams can be a little rocky coming out of the gates. We've seen that tonight.
And you know, JB, the main thing is special teams is the one aspect of the game that's almost impossible to do live in practice. You don't want your guys kickoff coverage, kick return, really running down their full speed 11 on 11. So generally the first game is the first time these guys actually have live 11 on 11 special teams action.
So the back, Stony Brook up 5 yards to the 25. Bogan on the USF receiving end moves up a corresponding 5 as well. Drew Evangelista went with the short kick on his previous attempt, and it is Wesley Skiffington, in fact, the local kid, who punts it away. Bogan fields at the 35, backstep still on his feet. Dontavia Bogan refusing to go down, and they'll finally spot him at the 34. So let's take a look back at just how the first couple of series have gone down, and Dontavia Bogan gave the Bulls the early momentum with the touchdown, but then on the punt, Farron Horns puts it on the ground. The Seawolves recover, they go to Gowans, and we're tied at 7.
And so far, USF is one play, one touchdown. We'll see, can this drive live up to the first?
Daniels under center. He has trouble with the exchange. Gives it to Brattle. Bradley Battles, who plunges ahead for three. And we'll check out the Stony Brook defense. A sophomore, a junior, and two seniors along the defensive line. Ryan Haber started every game of 2009. The Hofstra transfer, Reggie Franklin, then in the middle of the linebacking core. There are several Hofstra transfers in the Stony Brook 2D. Porter, West, Reyes, and Hutchins starting in the secondary. Hutchins, the only player who's seen these Bulls before tonight's contest. He dressed against USF for Rutgers last year. Daniels swings it out to Landy on second down. Landy, the converted quarterback, moves the chains. He picks up seven.
And guys like Evan Landy make your football team, JB. Here's a guy that came to South Florida with aspirations of replacing Matt Grofey. He gets bypassed on the depth chart by B.J. Daniels, doesn't sulk, doesn't become upset, simply says, coach, put me somewhere where I can help the team win. First game of 2010, he's starting at wide receiver. You need guys that are unselfish like that to have good quality programs.
This time a screen left. Again, they get it to Bogan. Makes a move at the 50 into Stony Brook territory. There is a flag on the field, and now another rains down. We'll await the explanation. Could be offsetting here. There was one in the USF line of scrimmage and another downfield where the tackle was made.
Illegal formation, offense, five players in the backfield, personal foul, defense. The penalties will offset, replay the down.
A referee, Dennis Hennigan, out of the Big East. So Daniels, who averaged more than 152 rushing yards per game as a freshman. Sean, we're seeing a different look already so far. He has become a pocket passer. They would prefer to not have the quarterback lead the team in rushing for the fifth consecutive year.
Yeah, it's one thing to have that ability. It's another thing to rely on it all the time. I think part of the maturation of BJ is that he's capable of beating you from the pocket now.
Throws downfield and to the sideline. No receiver in the vicinity. Stephen Bravo Brown, the walk-on freshman, the nearest man to it.
And I think that play there, JB, a lot of people look at it, don't take notice of it. That's a part of how BJ has matured. When you get a play call, the defense did a good job. They covered all of your receivers. You don't have to be Superman, throw the football away, because this team needs BJ Daniels healthy to have any chance to compete in the Big East this season.
Andreas Shields and Lindsey Lamar join the formation down to the near side of the field. Four receivers. They run the draw to Battles. He's met in the middle, but not before he picks up two. Battles came charging up the depth chart during camp, a redshirt freshman. They say he has the best burst of the options at running back. They have Mo Plancher there, Demetrius Murray, Marcus Shaw as well.
And throughout the night, JB, I think we'll see all of those guys in the backfield at some point. You know, Skip said that Coach Holtz said that he's very high on all of his backs, and all of them probably will see action tonight.
It's Murray this time. Daniels out of the shotgun. Can't find a receiver, so he'll keep the play alive to his left. Now throws downfield. Had Shields. He juggled it as he went out of bounds. They'll rule it incomplete. Andreas Shields at 6'4" creates one of the best mismatches the Bulls have downfield.
And I mentioned explosive in the open, JB. That's a big-time throw for a right-handed quarterback. Rolling to your left, being able to set your feet and put that kind of velocity on the throw. Your tight end's got to help you out a little bit out there right there. He's got to come up with that catch.
Justin Brockhaus-Kahn now on to punt. As the crowd gets a look at the replay, I'm not sure they could see in the detail we just did. The catch juggled as he went out of bounds. Kicked safely away by Kahn, a low liner. Gush will let it go. It bounces inside the 10, and a beautiful play by Dante Spires to down it there inside the 5, and the Seawolves will start deep in their own territory. Was a penalty on the play.
Illegal formation, kicking team, 5 players in the backfield, 5-yard penalty, 4th down.
Well, after about the best result you can hope for on a punt from near midfield, they'll have to do it again.
And in openers for college programs, I expect, you know, some sloppiness. You know, I expect some of these little lack of attention to detail type errors to occur because this is their first game. Unlike, you know, professional football, the NFL, you don't get the opportunity to iron out the kinks, you know, in preseason contests. You have to come straight from practice and be prepared and ready to go. And you know, honestly, when you're dealing with 17 to 21-year-olds, you're probably going to make some mistakes along the way.
The Bulls backed up to their 41 now. And you can see they're changing balls on the field as they had brought out the Stony Brook offensive football and will instead go back to the USF punting football. That's the one that Brockhaus Khan likes. See if he can pin the Seawolves deep in their own territory again. Does well to handle the snap, but he was whistled down. Had to go to a knee to field the punt, so another huge change of field position. Instead of trapped inside their own five, you can see the look on Skip Holt's face as the Seawolves will take over at the 26.
And for the second, you know, snap in a row, Mike Walsh kind of one-hopped the ball down there. And, you know, Justin Brockhaus Khan, in going down to get the ball, his knee must have touched the turf.
See Coach Holtz there having a conversation with his sophomore punter. Disappointing result there for Brockhaus Khan after a terrific kick. The first go-round was erased. Jakulski in the backfield now for the Seawolves with Coulter under center. They fake the handoff to him and now throw back left side. Caught, and he will go into the end zone. The Seawolves have taken the lead. Sean, they fake the handoff to him out of the backfield. And he runs downfield and scores on the sideline.
Excellent call by the Seawolves. This is a bootleg action, but actually the running back that he fakes the handoff to runs what's called a wheel route up the sideline. And Jaquan Williams does a good job of covering it. He just misses the ball completely, turns into a Stony Brook touchdown. And now if you're Skip Holtz, you got to get your guys to get on the sideline, say just calm down. I know we're excited. You know, they're making some mental errors, a fumble on special teams, the punter kneeling down, and you find yourselves trailing.
For the second time in the first quarter, Stony Brook capitalizes on a special teams mistake by the Bulls. They've taken a touchdown lead in Tampa. JB Long and Sean King with you in Tampa. Stony Brook on top of USF, 14-7. And those who have made the trip down from Long Island rejoicing, and I think the Bulls, while they may be enjoying the dancing festivities here during the break, a little bit stunned, Sean, by what's taken place here in the opening quarter of play.
And it's all revolved around special teams. Right now, South Florida is not getting the execution they need from their special teams, and it's hurting them.
Another short kick from Skiffington. Bogan at the 20 with the wheels rolling. Breaks right side. There's a flag as he gets out near midfield. We'll see if the return stands by Dontavia Bogan of nearly 30 yards.
During the return, illegal block in the back. Number 13, 10-yard penalty, first down.
So that'll back B.J. Daniels and the Bulls up. Let's take a look at some of the key returners that USF does bring back to the field this year. And, of course, Daniels leads the way. Mo Plancher has been slowed by a shoulder injury. We've yet to see him in action tonight. Bogan, of course, caught the first touchdown pass, and defensively, some of the names we've called already. Williams nearly deflected that previous pass away. Instead, it went for a Stony Brook touchdown. Trips right now for Daniels in the shotgun. He will throw that way. Lindsey Lamar picks up good yardage on first down.
And Evan Lindy, the wide receiver, doesn't get a lot of credit right there, but that play takes so much trust for Lindsey Lamar, knowing that Evan's going to get the block, because if he doesn't, it's going to be a blow-up. Great job by Lindy of getting his guy on the ground so that Lindsey Lamar can get positive yardage for this South Florida team.
Landy up top in the formation now. Two receivers to the near side of the field. Again, it's Lamar and Bogan with Demetrius Murray in the backfield. Daniels buys time, finds Landy, and Landy was one tackler away from pay dirt.
And this is actually a hitch, JB, that turns into an adjustment because they're playing this cloud corner look. Great job by BJ of being patient. Great job by Landy. And that's where that former quarterback comes in. He understands coverages, understands the adjustments he needs to make.
Todd Fitch goes to a little bit of a no-huddle to speed up the tempo and perhaps spark his Bulls. It's worked as they move the chains on back-to-back plays. Demetrius Murray, 11 yards on the ground. Let's go down to the sideline now and check in with Victoria Lynn to get a feel for how the crowd here at Raymond James is reacting.
Boy, how the crowd has changed quite a bit, JB. Before the team even came into the stadium, everyone was on their feet hooting and hollering. That second touchdown from the Seawolves kind of took the air out of this balloon. I think they're waiting to see what this drive does. You can see them trying to get their energy back. We'll see what happens. Back to you.
Daniels on the read. He keeps it, his first scramble of the game, and does pick up positive yardage. They'll mark him out of bounds inside the 25-yard line. We'll call it the 24. Gain of 7.
And JB, BJ Daniels can definitely pick him up and put him down. You have not gotten an opportunity as of yet tonight to really see him in the open field, but he's just so gifted athletically. And he's developing as a passer. You saw the throw up the sideline to Landy. You saw the touchdown pass to Dontavia Bogan. The sky's the limit for this young man. He may not be a national name right now, but at the end of this year, going into next year, he'll be one of those guys that's on everybody's short list to have a chance to win a Heisman, you know, to be a very successful player at the next level.
Those rushing yards skewed, as they often are for quarterbacks, by some sack yardage in terms of positive scrambles, as we have a delay of game penalty
game
on Daniel and the
number
Bulls.
Number 7 offense, 5-yard penalty, second down.
As I was saying, his positive rush is well over 1,000 yards from the quarterback position in 10 games.
You know, I was always a guy, I never understood why the quarterback's rushing total, the sacks were taken away from that. I just didn't understand that.
Well, just so announcers like I can point out that, in fact, you did gain more positive yardage and make your numbers look that much better.
It's one of the flaws, definitely, in the rule-keeping.
Daniels swings it out to Landy. At the first down marker and beyond, inside the 20. That wide receiver screen has been the most successful play so far for the Bulls.
Well, I'm very impressed with offensive coordinator Todd Fitch so far. You know, Stony Brook is trying to keep that outside linebacker in the box to prevent South Florida from running the football. When he does that, you throw that quick screen to that slot receiver, and you can get a lot of positive yardage during the course of a football game.
The Bulls continue to work no huddle now from the 16, and 3 catches already for Evan Landy. Offset eye behind Daniels again to throw. Again, it's Landy at the 11. Stiff arm and out of bounds. Gain of 6. Landy, who is recruited as a defensive back and a quarterback, redshirted as a signal caller in 2009, played both quarterback and wide receiver in the spring, so he wears many hats for this USF football team, but has settled in at wide receiver.
And one of the things we haven't mentioned thus far on the broadcast, JB, is how big these USF wide receivers are. Landy goes 6'4", Dontavia Bogan 6'2". That presents a lot of problems, you know, when balls are in the air for those guys.
Murray, right up the middle. Doesn't even get hit until he's inside the 5. It'll be first and goal, Bulls. I think Todd Fitch making the decision, you know what, we're bigger, we're deeper, and this is our home turf. We're going to come out and establish it here on this drive after they fell behind 14-7.
And I definitely think he understands it's a four-quarter game. You know, Stony Brook is coming from a colder climate than what they're experiencing tonight. You definitely want to be a physical offense against this Stony Brook team. I hope that they wear down as the game goes on.
Two receivers up top, Bogan, as Daniels keeps it, and he has room right side. Over the top, into the end zone, B.J. Daniels, his first rushing touchdown of 2010.
And, JB, that's just a little bit of that otherworldly athleticism that he has. You saw it with the Michael Vick. You saw it with the Pat White, with the Donovan McNabb. You know, the acceleration to get outside, and then the hops. See, I never had the hops. See, if I would have tried to do that, probably been a 3-yard loss.
There is an injured Seawolf down on the play. We'll get the number 2 as best we can as we see Coach Holtz communicating with his quarterback and running through what took place on that drive.
You know, and he's more than likely telling BJ, great play, but listen, don't do that unless you have to. If you can go over to that pylon, and because we can't afford to lose you, son.
They sure can. That's why they've tried to limit some of his running, but, boy, you get in that red zone, you get along the goal line, and sometimes it just becomes irresistible on those zone reads. Daniels, a first-team All-Big East selection, according to Phil Steele. Take a look at some of the other honorees for the USF Bulls. Kayvon Webster, a first-team cornerback, but he was actually beaten out at the cornerback position. I think the secondary is one of the biggest concerns, Sean, for this team back in the spring. It's actually become perhaps a position of strength and depth.
And I was going to say, you hit it right on the head, JB, depth. You can never have enough depth. Anytime you have guys that are on the preseason, all Big East, all American teams, and they get beat out, that means that, you know what, you're doing a good job recruiting. You're continually creating competition, and that's what makes you good. When guys know they have to show up and compete, you know, that makes your overall ball club that much better.
That looks like 33 Reggie Franklin, the starting middle linebacker for the Stony Brook Seawolves. That would be a big loss if indeed he is unable to return. Another Hofstra transfer there. And the extra point is good for the Bulls. So after falling behind by a touchdown, a sustained drive for USF, and I think they feel a lot more comfortable with the score at 14 up.
Well, the special teams didn't get in the way. You know, if you think back to it, you know, all of Stony Brook's points have been off of special teams errors. You have the fumble by Horn, you have the punter kneeling down, which gave them great field position both times. Other than that, I mean, the defense has performed outstanding.
Well, we have a moment. A reminder that the NCAA men's basketball first and second rounds return to Tampa Bay in 2011. So save the dates, March 17th and 19th at the St. Petersburg Times Forum. Tickets are on sale now through NCAAtickets.com. Don't miss your chance to be part of one of the most exciting events in college athletics, the NCAA Basketball Tournament. Get your tickets now through NCAAtickets.com for the 2011 tourney first and second rounds hosted by USF and the St. Petersburg Times Forum. So we're back to where we started, Sean. Almost 14 minutes ago in terms of game time. USF Bulls kicking off. Score even. What have we accomplished so far? Perhaps knocking off some of the rust, if nothing else. But another special teams blunder there as the kick goes out of bounds.
And Vernon Hargraves, who's a special teams coach for the South Florida, he has to be pulling his hair out on the sideline right now.
Kickoff out of bounds by the kicking team. Ball will be placed at the 40-yard line. First down.
Good explanation there by our referee, Dennis Hennigan, and that's where the Seawolves will take over. And Coach Hargraves, one of the most active in practice.
And you know, it's unique. Like, having been in the locker room before, like, the relationship with the kickers and the rest of the team is such a funny, you know, experience. And you look at your kicker when he comes off the field, like, you know, you have 53.5 yards to keep the ball in play. Can we please just kick it somewhere inside the numbers? How difficult is that?
Proving to be so far, but again, early in the 2010 season, and USF putting a special emphasis on special teams this season has not paid off yet, but you know that as we get deeper and deeper into the year, they will continue to harp on those kick teams. Three receivers set now for Coulter, working out of the shotgun with Masonette to his right. Rushes on. He gets it away, but incomplete. Terrell McClain there, applying the pressure for the Bulls.
Good play call, bad execution. You know, one way to negate a team with a very strong pass rush is to try and throw those slow screens to your running backs behind that pass rush. Running back falls down, not that accurate of a pass, but it's definitely something I think the Stony Brook offense will come back to, because USF right now, their defensive linemen are getting up the field trying to put pressure on Coulter.
We'll stack the box here on second and 10. The give is to Masonette. He slides through a tackle and another out near first down yardage at midfield. Mike Linares covered him up at the 50.
And that's one of the things, you know, being the first game, you're a little rusty on your fundamentals, you're a little off as far as your detail when it comes to tackling in the open field, and a little shifty back like that can hurt you.
But go with the sneak. Coulter does move the chains. into Bulls territory at the 49. We tick inside a minute to play here in the first quarter. Be first and 10 Seawolves from the 49. Chris McMillan checks into the ballgame, the receiver to the bottom of your screen. Coulter under center with Gowans behind him. Bootleg, near side. The throw just behind Jordan Gush, but what a catch. He juggles it and brings it down before he runs out of bounds at the 41.
And right now, Jeff Merrim, who's the offensive coordinator for Stony Brook, I mean, he's dialing it up. I mean, he has the right phone number, and he's calling at the right time of day. Everything that he's calling is giving his offense an opportunity to be successful. If you're USF, they're a little bit on their heels now. You know, you have to start thinking about maybe making some adjustments because Stony Brook is moving the football offensively.
The Bulls will have to wait for their chance
that
to stop
the
them
the first quarter.
As the clock does first. So we will take a break here. After one quarter of play, some special teams blunders, and the Stony Brook Seawolves in it with the Bulls in Tampa. We're tied at 14. Back with you in Tampa, J.B. Long and Sean King. Victoria Lim down on the sidelines after one period of play. We're tied at 14. Stony Brook and USF, and the Seawolves have the ball in Bulls territory at the 41. Mark Joyce into the ballgame defensively, as is Sabbath Joseph for the Bulls. They'll run it in second and short before they can. A procedural
ball
penalty.
Start, 69 offense, 5-yard penalty, second down.
So that'll take them back to the 46 and perhaps just the break that USF defense needs to put the clamps down.
And Mark Snyder, you know, he's not wasting any time. Already you can see some substitution patterns starting to form. You know, Dede Lattimore had beaten out Sabbath Joseph, who was a leading tacker last year at linebacker for USF. He's back in the game. True freshman Joyce is back there at safety. He's not happy with the way this defense is tackling.
Gush made that nice catch to keep this drive alive up the top of your screen. Gowans gets the carry. He breaks it right side. He gets back to near where the Seawolves had it before the penalty. It'll set up third and a long three. Joseph suffered a mild concussion during training camp and missed some time. He does return with 50 tackles. It's actually the fewest number of tackles for the leading returner in USF history, just to give you a feel for how much was lost from this USF defense in the offseason. See if they can hold here on third and call it four. Coulter, play action. Rolls to his right, gets it away. Under pressure, it's intercepted. Mike Linares at the 38-yard line. Linares, who got the start at middle linebacker after recording just one tackle in 2009, his contributions mainly on special teams, but the sophomore out of Lake Mary, a big momentum play.
And this is an outstanding job of making the play. You know, a lot of times, JB, defensively, guys are in position but don't make the play. Not only is Linares where he's supposed to be, he has that fullback blanketed in the flat, but, you know, a throw that's off target a little bit, he punctuates that bad throw by turning it into an interception, not just a pass breakup.
Joel Miller joins the receiving corps and gets a quick throw his way. A good block from Bogan out to the 45, call it the 46. Joel Miller with a nice gain on first down. Miller, of course, the former walk-on, one of seven former walk-ons now on scholarship for the Bulls. And at the center of that controversy that preceded the head coaching change here, but Coach Holtz saying he got the scholarship because he earned it in camp. Splits out to the top of your screen now. Daniels in the shotgun. They'll hand it to Murray. Big hole right side. A first down as he is popped by Aaron West. Let's go down to the sideline for an injury update with Victoria.
Number 33, Reginald Franklin on Stony Brook, who hobbled off the field towards the end of the first quarter. He right now has a big ice bag on his right knee. Trainers tell me they'll evaluate him at halftime. We don't know whether or not he's going to come back in the game. Back to you.
Thank you, Victoria. Again, three receivers and a handoff to Murray on first down. Murray in his career, just 14 attempts for 77 yards coming in, but the redshirt sophomore out of Georgia getting a good look here in the second quarter. His cousin, actually, former NFL running back Garrison Hurst, a name I'm sure you're familiar with and remember, Sean.
He was decent. He was really good at an outstanding career at University of Georgia.
Now 4-1, Daniels with heat in his face, gets it away. They set up the screen to Murray, and he's got room to roam with blockers in front of him. Inside the 30, tripped up at the 24. A beautifully executed screen pass. B.J. Daniels stands tall.
And, J.B., you have no idea how good of a play this is by B.J. Daniels. You know, a lot of quarterbacks on a screen like this, they lose their composure. B.J. hangs in the pocket under duress, makes an accurate throw that Demetrius can immediately turn upfield with, and that's what creates the big play. And this offense is a little different with Demetrius Murray at running back. I know they're trying to keep, you know, Mo Plancher, you know, on the sideline because of a shoulder injury, but Murray's making a case to be the guy.
The starting corner for the Stony Brook side, Donald Porter, is the injured player. So we will take a break and update you on his status when we come back. USF driving at the 24. Back in Tampa, Mike Linares, his interception gave the Bulls the ball in good field position, and they've driven it to the 24-yard line. B.J. Daniels with Evan Landy to his right, Dontavia Bogan up top. Quarterback under center, and he'll take a timeout.
South Florida, first time out of the half.
We'll stay right here. And Sean, one of the things I've noticed here with Daniels early is for a guy who has a reputation as a big play quarterback, he's throwing at or near the line of scrimmage quite a bit.
And I think you're going to see a little bit of this evolution as he changes to a new offense. You know, Jim Leavitt, you know, Mike Canales, and that system have moved on. In comes Skip Holtz and Top Fitch and what they like to do with the football. If you look at East Carolina the last couple years, you know, Skip Holtz was the head guy. They won Conference USA the last 2 years. They're a very efficient offense. You know, they manufacture big plays. They don't necessarily always try and create them. But I think it also says a lot about BJ's maturity. You know, Rich Rodriguez, when I was at Tulane, used to always tell me, you can never go broke taking a profit. When you have guys open, you get the football to them, let them do what they do, we'll win a lot of football games.
Back in the shotgun here on first and 10. Handoff goes to Murray. He picks his way up the middle to about the 20. And when you talked with BJ after practice the other day, you asked him how he feels about the package that Coach Fitch has put in for him, and there is a gleam in his eye.
He likes it. You know, he understands that this is the next step in becoming a big-time player at this position. Everyone knows how athletic he is. They know he can run from sideline to sideline and create plays. This year, you're going to see a guy that can stay in the pocket when he needs to, can, you know, elude the rush when he needs to. You're just going to see a complete player at the quarterback position.
Fullback Richard Kelly there in the backfield with Murray. He's been the lead blocker for most of the night. On second and 6, they sweep left. Good pursuit by that Stony Brook defense. A gain of maybe 1. We're right at the 20-yard line. Credit Jonas Rousseau there on the pursuit. Senior defensive end. A late addition to the starting lineup for the Seawolves.
And I think a lot of credit, you know, also JB has to go to Chuck Priore and their staff. They're taking away the big play from this South Florida offense ever since Dontavia Bogan went up the sideline. They're making USF work for it. They could not ask for a better scenario right here. You talk midway through the second quarter, a tie ball game.
Second time out of the half.
Still with a chance. You know, those movies, Hoosiers and all those things where the underdog wins, you know, this is how, you know, they occur. You know, you find a way to get the game to the fourth quarter and then see if you can win it.
Third and 6 from the 20 when we come back. USF looking to take the lead on Stony Brook. The Bulls have gone 42 yards in six plays since the Linares interception. They're now faced with third and six from the 20. Daniels with four receivers to work with in the shotgun. Again, they try to set up the screen. Joel Miller can't hang on. The throw behind him, and so a decision here on third and a long six. Skip Holtz will send out the field goal unit. Well, Sean, I know you were looking for seven there. You felt the Bulls need it to really seize control of the game again. But instead, the Bulls opt for three here.
Well, also understand this is not a gimme field goal.
Eric Schwartz, 11-16 a year ago. Kick long enough, and it is through. So Eric Schwartz nails his first three-point try of the season, and the Bulls are back on top 17-14. They do put points on the board after that Mike Linares interception.
A good answer by the South Florida Bulls offense. However, you know, being a former quarterback, JB, when you're playing an opponent and you feel like athletically, you know, from a size standpoint, you know, we're better than them, then, you know, we would go into games saying, you know what, we're going to score every time. And I think that, you know, BJ and that offense have the same kind of expectation, and it's disappointing. You know, when you get down there, you have opportunities, and you have to take advantage of them. Having said that, it's the first game. So everything's not going to be fine-tuned. You know, the car is not going to run as well the day you take it off the lot as maybe you get a little more comfortable with how to turn the air conditioner on, you know, how to skip songs on the CD player.
Well, we've seen it throughout the country on this opening weekend of college football. It does take a while to get in your rhythm, and there have been lesser teams that have hung with better teams, to put it simply, for the better part of the first half. And USF still with plenty of time to play here, obviously, and to establish themselves as the dominant program on the field tonight.
And you saw it all around the country. Jacksonville State upset Ole Miss. Up in Gainesville today, University of Florida, very slow start offensively. You know, John Brantley came in with a lot of hype. He actually did not play that bad. They had a lot of trouble. Center to QB exchange, different things that allowed Miami of Ohio to stay in that football game.
Mikon Benani put the last one out of bounds. You saw Skip Holtz with a conversation with his kicker before this one, and that ball will be down at the 11. So a good break on special teams for the Bulls for perhaps the first time tonight. Miles Campbell had to go to the turf to cover it. And so Coulter will take over with the Stony Brook offense at the 12. And he's got a pretty big offensive line in front of him. We can show you some of the numbers of just how big this Seawolves offensive line is. 300 pounds almost across the board. But, Sean, I think you and I could put our mind to it and reach 300 pounds. The key is being that big and still being able to move your feet.
And Michael Bomero, 6'8", 350. What's he doing playing football? He didn't see all the money Amari Stoudemire got from the New York Knicks.
Good rush defense by the Bulls there on first down. The center of that line stuffs things up. Keith McCaskill in on it. McCaskill, a junior out of Tallahassee. David Bedford there as well. He's second down and 10 from the 12. No gain officially on the play. Jakulski is the running back. Three-man rotation in the backfield for the Seawolves. Bull showing blitz from the corner. It does come. Coulter gets it away. Deflected. Quentin Washington got a hand on it. It was intended for Campbell. That'll bring up third and long.
Very good play on the football by Quentin Washington. Again, you know, these cornerbacks in South Florida has been well coached. You saw Skinny Raymond do it earlier. Here you see Quentin Washington understanding time and watch. He arrives at the football as the football is arriving to the receiver. Doesn't have to push the receiver out of the way and give the back referee an opportunity to call a defensive pass interference. Great job by Quentin Washington.
They'll bring George Baker onto the field here as well. An extra defensive back. Stony Brook goes three wide on third and 10. Play clock winding down. Coulter does give it off. They run the draw and stacked up in the backfield. Sabbath Joseph there to meet him. Seawolves will have to punt.
And Sabbath Joseph is the leading returning tackler on this South Florida team. Lost his starting linebacker job to Dede Lattimore. He's making a case tonight that he wants it back, and he's going to put some tape out that's going to make the decision very tough as they head to Gainesville next week to face the Gators.
See Craig Marshall there, the player we highlighted in the open, in on that tackle as well, and comes off after a three-and-out series for the Bulls. So they took the lead with the field goal. Now a chance to gain some field position as well. And the punt is loose in the end zone. Blocked. The Bulls have to fall on it. Touchdown. A poor exchange from center, and South Florida pounces on it. Chris Lane, the special teamer. The unexpected touchdown.
And, JB, that's poetic justice. One unit that has been the thorn in the side of the University of South Florida Bulls tonight finally gets some get back, comes up with points of their own. You love that. If you're Vernon Hargraves, you don't have to pull out as much air. Right now he was planning on going bald after tonight's contest, but this allows him to at least maintain a mohawk at the least.
Bulls get the snap off, and the kick is up and through. So momentum changing plays throughout the first half. At one point they gave Stony Brook the upset lead, but now the Bulls have rallied. Cheers all around for Chris Lane there. Special teams contribution, it just goes to show you never know who and you never know when. Let me take a look at some of the turnovers that we've seen already tonight, and it started early on the Bulls side, really just returning kicks and punts. Farron Horns had a tough time hanging on to it early. And then we saw punt exchange go awry for the Bulls. An interception by Mike Linares to set up the field goal. And now this.
And a coaching point to all kickers out there, punters. Drew Evangelista right now, he gets to the sideline. They'll tell him, when the ball's over your head, you're in the end zone, go ahead and run out the back of the end zone. Give up the 2 points as opposed to the six.
So in the snap of a finger, the Bulls go from being in a somewhat tenuous situation to comfortably up 10. Still with 9:12 to play here in the second quarter. And the defense, after forcing a three and out and forcing that punt, will be right back on the field. Bonani puts a foot into it. Jakulski from his three. Weatherspoon there to make the tackle. Reserve linebacker making a nice play on special teams. Seawolves will start from inside their own 20.
And JB, right now, if you're on that Stony Brook sideline, you have to get your guys, you have to calm them down, you have to find a way just to get a couple first downs. You don't have to score, you don't have to create a big play, but you've got to get a couple first downs, because if you go three and out right here, you know this game could get out of hand in a hurry.
They'll start from the 17. And a false start there. They'll back
false
it up five
start,
more.
69 offense, 5 yard penalty, first down.
Do you think there was some wow factor there, Sean, when the Seawolves looked up and saw the bigger number next to their name on the scoreboard?
Well, I think coming into this game, they fully anticipated, you know, that they could play with South Florida. You know, I played at Tulane, which is a smaller program, and anytime we got the opportunity to play a bigger school, we had a chip on our shoulder. But at the same time, if you want to compete, if you want to have a chance to win, you have to be able to execute and try and play mistake-free, and they have not done that throughout the entire night.
Bootleg right, it's been their favorite play. Lepore makes the catch. Gets back to roughly the original line of scrimmage before Sabbath Joseph runs him out of bounds. Give him the 11-yard line. Call it the 12. So to set up second and 11. Coulter came to Stony Brook by way of Syracuse and Santa Ana College. This is junior season. Majoring in biochemistry and throw a Spanish minor on top of that. So a smart kid as the flags fly on second and long. The throw incomplete. We'll send it back to Dennis Hennigan. procedural call. And Skip Holtz will opt to send him back.
Illegal formation, 69 offense, lined up in the backfield, 5-yard penalty, second down.
So second and 16 now.
And Skip Holtz right now is thinking turnover. He's thinking defensive turnover. He's hoping that Stony Brook gets a little too aggressive. The culture throws the ball up that they can get their hands on and get great field position for their offense.
They'll stay conservative. Give it to Gowans. Good pursuit from the weak side. And you got maybe two. Anthony Hill there. Tackle. Hill, a sophomore out of Pensacola. We went through the preseason, Sean. The coaches talked about the depth they have both at the tackle and the end position. I think you're seeing a lot of that here tonight. Some of the starters being rotated out for the likes of Anthony Hill. And if they can't beat you with the names that maybe they did a year ago, they'll certainly beat you with numbers in 2010.
It keeps you fresh. And, you know, it's such a luxury to be able to do that. You know, defensively, they have just so many guys that can run and tackle. And defensive coordinator all over the country tell you that's a great position to be in.
Coulter on third and 14 does hit his man, but it won't be nearly enough to pick up a first down. So the Bulls with another three and out, and they scored off the previous punt. We'll see what they can do here. Johnny sitting deep to receive for the Bulls. Reserve running back, saw him work with the special teams units quite a bit this week in practice. He's back there as well on the previous punt, although it never reached him. There's Sitton. This time a clean snap and the kick is away. From the 45, straight up field, room to run left. Sitton inside the 40 and the 30, pushed out of bounds at the 35. Great field position once more for the USF Bulls. Take a break there. When we come back, DJ Daniels and the offense back on the field. They have a 10-point lead, looking for more in Tampa. BJ Daniels and the Bulls back on the field with 6:52 left in the first half of play. And after the great punt return, they'll have tremendous field position starting from the 26. Mo Plancher in the ball game for the first time. Daniels, though, wants it all. Looking for Bogan to the end zone. Deflected away, incomplete. Devontae Anderson on the coverage for Stony Brook. Let's go to the field for an update on Donald Porter with Victoria.
Hey, JB. Donald Porter, number 6 for Stony Brook, wide receiver who came out in the game earlier in the second quarter. He is out for the game. Injury to his right knee. Back to you.
Thank you, Victoria. And that is why we saw Anderson in there on that last play. Daniels perhaps going to the inexperienced side and test him early on. This time they go with Plancher. His first carry. He picks up a first down, a gain of 11 by Mo Plancher, who is the incumbent, the senior from Naples. Slowed in camp by a shoulder injury. This is for a guy that earned a sixth-year medical redshirt. We saw Battles get some time, Demetrius Murray as well, and now Plancher.
You know, Plancher has what you call sweet feet. You know, he's one of those guys that in traffic, you know, he still maintains his agility, his elusiveness. You know, you mentioned that shoulder injury. Coach Holt still said he wanted to see him get hit a couple times tonight in live action.
Now B.J. Daniels will use the feet. He gets to the 10 before he's spun down. That'll leave second and 5. Another Seawolf shaking up on the play. Stop the clock there. It's like a defensive lineman.
You know, if you're Chuck Priore, you have to be very concerned. You know, guys are getting hurt, it seems like, every series with Stony Brook. He's going to look behind him and not have anybody to substitute in.
Talked about the shoulder on Murray there. How about the shoulder on B.J. Daniels, who, of course, had the operation on his non-throwing shoulder in the offseason, was in the red jersey. for all of spring, and the Bulls were just ecstatic that he was able to participate in spring drills and start to get a grasp of the system. We haven't seen him run much, and that's by design. But he did there, and I think collectively everyone in the USF fan base holds their breath anytime he leaves the pocket, not necessarily because of the repaired shoulder, but knowing that they're one play away at any point. We can report that Michael Marino, the injured Seawolf on the play, able to walk off under his own power. So the clock runs at 6 minutes. Now from the 10, the Bulls will have second and five. Bogan and Landy to the bottom of your screen. Richard Kelly, the fullback. Plancher in the eye. They'll pitch right. Plancher cuts back. Finds running room inside the five and bulls his way for another first down to the 3.
Remember I mentioned sweet feet. Just watch the ability to make the defender lean one way or the other, create some gap, explode through it. Great run by Plancher. You know, with the success that Demetrius Murray had, you know, USF really, you know, has one of those running back tandems of all, and I think it's going to help them immensely once they get into their Big East schedule.
Bogan to the bottom of your screen, Landy up top. Again, the I formation with Plancher and Kelly. They give it to the fullback. He's met at the line of scrimmage, may have lost one there. Nice defensive play by Dominic Reyes coming up from his safety position.
And I love that play call right there. It may not seem like a lot, but those fullbacks are just like offensive linemen. They're overworked, underappreciated, you know, especially in offense that doesn't utilize them. Like, say, we used Mike Allstott when I was at Tampa. You give Richard Kelly an opportunity to run the football. Now he's got to pay attention every time you tell him, you know what, you might actually get the ball Saturday.
This time they go to Plancher. Buys his time in the backfield, but Aaron West, the first man to him, wraps him up, and that'll set up third and goal. You know, Sean, the Bulls were terrific in the red zone last year. They scored on 37 out of their 40 trips in 2009. 27 of those were touchdowns. We'll see if they can punch it in here. And that's as much an art as it is a science, scoring in the red zone. When you get that field condensed, you have to find creative ways to get it in the end zone, don't you?
Yeah, and I would anticipate that they'll try and get B.J. Daniels outside of the pocket, give him some options to throw, also some options to run the football if there's no one open.
They bring in Shields and Lindsey Lamar, four receivers to work with, two to each side. Daniels out of the shotgun. He will scramble left. Now cuts back. Look at what he can do with his feet. Don't know if it will be enough. He reaches to the one, but stopped there. Well, he is magic when he uses those feet. We'll see if Coach Holtz will go for it on fourth and goal from the one. B.J. Daniels wants it, you can see. And they will go. .13 on the play clock here. They may have to burn a timeout, as I'm not sure they got the transition they were looking for.
South Florida, second timeout of the half.
And while we have a moment, let's go to the sideline. That most recent injury.
30-second timeout.
Mike Marino, Victoria Lim on the sideline.
JB, Michael Marino, the linebacker for Stony Brook. He has a right shoulder injury. He will recheck it at halftime, but he is out for the rest of this quarter. Back to you.
Thank you, Victoria. So that starting defense for the Seawolves slowly but surely becoming depleted. We saw Reggie Franklin, the middle linebacker, first, then Donald Porter, the starting corner, and now one of those interior linemen, Marino. This is as much a war of attrition as anything else, even here in week one. And the buzzword in any coaching locker room is depth. At this point in the season, it's why you recruit. It's why you protect your players as best you can.
And Stony Brook's at a disadvantage. They're from the Northeast region. You know, they're coming down to Tampa where it's extremely hot. But not only is it hot, it's extremely humid. And even though, you know, it's at night, so there is no sun in the air, that humidity has to start to impact you from a fatigue standpoint. Once you get fatigued, injuries just occur.
Double tight end set here. Kevin Guidry to B.J. Daniels right. Mo Plancher again in the backfield behind Kelly. Send Guidry in motion. Fourth and goal from the one. It's Plancher. Can he find his way in? Fighting at the goal line. The officials run in, and Stony Brook turns him over on down.
And that's a great job by that Stony Brook defense of manning up. You know, Skip Holtz basically said, you know what, I want to see if my guys in a fourth and goal situation are physical enough to push Stony Brook off the line of scrimmage and get us into the end zone. Stony Brook said, not today, coach.
Certainly a big play by the Stony Brook defense, but now the USF defense comes out and they have to consider this an opportunity with the ball spotted inside the 1 yard line, a chance for them to score.
And this is why I like the aggressiveness of that fourth and short or fourth and goal play call, because if you do not get the touchdown, you know, you can still potentially get another opportunity to score by getting a three and out.
Coulter audibling at the line of scrimmage, the play clock at 5. Gowans met in the backfield, somehow manages to get out of the end zone. Patrick Hampton, I believe, got a piece of him inside the painted stuff. Gowans did well to escape there. Pickup of 2, and that gives Stony Brook some breathing room. Again, the crowd creating some noise along that goal line. 2nd and 8 for Stony Brook. Coulter to Gowans once more. Into the pile and pushes it forward for 4. So really a key third down here, Sean. I think if you're USF, an important stop, maybe get one more offensive possession before the half and a chance to expand on this 10-point lead.
And I was going to say, you know, defensive for USF, this is a big third down. You know, you want to get off the field. You know, great defenses, defenses that, you know, year in and year out perform at a high level. They're great on third down. You have offense backed up. They have a third and, you know, 4 situation. You have to ensure that they do not pick this first down up. You give B.J. Daniels and that offense an opportunity to work on their 2-minute offense. They've been doing it all offseason, all throughout training camp. Give them opportunity before the half to go down and, you know, create a little more breathing room than 10 points. 10 points looks good. Doesn't look as good as 17.
Tough break here on third down as Stony Brook will lose Brian Crew, the starting left guard, for at least one play. He was helped off. They face 3rd and a long 4. USF showing pressure. Coulter in the shotgun. Looks to throw with a hand in his face downfield, no one home. And so the USF defense does stand. Terrell McClain, the dancing bear, nearly danced his way to a safety.
And this is a great job. You see the persistence, you know, initially stopped by the offensive pass protection, but continues to the quarterback, forces Coulter to get rid of the ball quicker than he wanted to. Now you get an opportunity, you know, to have tremendous field position and get another score right before the half.
So again, Sitton to return the punt. He stands inside Stony Brook territory at the 45. Evangelista awaits the snap. It's a good one, and the kick safely away. Sitton lost control. Ball's loose. Stony Brook can't control it. Neither can Sanchez for USF. Finally, a pile inside the 40. Bulls just can't seem to find any answers right now on the punt team. They do maintain control of the football.
Well, JB, I know one job that will be available in Tampa come tomorrow, and that's the starting punt returner from University of South Florida. You know, if you look around the country, you know, a lot of times, you know, teams will put a guy back there that's not as explosive, that doesn't have really the ability to take it to the house, but a guy that's reliable from a fielding standpoint, a guy who they know is going to field the ball, maintain possession, and not create turnovers.
Looked like Evan Landy saved the possession. I'd say all's well that ends well, but I'm not sure Coach Holtz would agree at this point. B.J. Daniels does get another possession, though. Inside 2 minutes, he hands off to Murray for a gain of 2. Craig Richardson there with the tackle.
And let's see if we can get some of these younger receivers, Stephen Bravo Brown, T.J. Knowles, Lindsey Lamar, see if some of these guys can get involved in the offense a little bit on this 2-minute drive.
Bravo Brown into the mix, as is Lamar. That's the target for B.J. Daniels, but he is leveled at the 40. Dominic Reyes came up to deliver the hit. I'm not sure Lamar would have been able to hang on even without the contact, but he's shaken up as he makes his way back to the sideline. Those are the throws your quarterbacks aren't supposed to make.
And actually, you know, a lot of people look at that and say that's an inaccurate throw. B.J. threw that ball exactly where he wanted to. You know, he had to back shoulder it because the cornerback had gotten depth, so he couldn't throw it to the sideline. It's actually just a very good play by the safety.
Part of it is the reality of what the Bulls and B.J. Daniels are working with in terms of shorter receivers. In the person of Lindsey Lamar, it runs 5'8", 164, and so that throw, had it been to Evan Landy or Dontavia Bogan or maybe someone like T.J. Knowles, goes down as a simple completion. Lamar, out of Hillsborough High School, a converted running back to provide some depth at wide receiver. Get him into the slot, see if he can continue here. He was a bit shaken up. But now an important third down with 1:05 on the clock before the half. 7 yards to go with Daniels in the shotgun. Again, four receivers. Under pressure. Eludes it easily. Now looks downfield. Right to the sideline. Steven Bravo Brown. Two toes down and a first down. Well, how about the story on Bravo Brown? 5'10", a freshman walk-on. Not in the starting lineup, but certainly worked his way onto the two deep. Out of St. Thomas Aquinas High School in North Lauderdale. There's some good receivers that have come out of there.
Yeah, they produce some great ones. Chris Carter and that staff, they do an excellent job. Seems like every year, you know, they have three or four guys that are in the ESPN top 150.
Michael Irvin, the name that comes to mind when I think of St. Thomas Aquinas. First down inside of a minute. Daniels again to Bravo Brown. Look at the hands at the 35. It'll be just shy of a first down.
And you mentioned it, JB. He does an excellent job of snatching this football. You know, B.J. Daniels, look at the ball placement. Ball's a foot in front of the numbers, exactly where it's supposed to be. Bravo Brown catches the ball with his hands, gets north and south.
Out of the shotgun, 33 seconds on the clock as Daniels goes, and he's under pressure, can't take the sack here, somehow stays on his feet. It will be a first down at the 31-yard line. The elusiveness from Daniels, simply incredible.
And that's a big play because the first down means the clock stops while they reset the chains, so you don't have to waste the timeout. You can kill the football.
They do spike it there. It stops with 20 seconds on the clock. And so, Sean King, what's your play call here? Do you start taking shots at the end zone or try to work a little bit closer in the next play or two?
Well, you have two timeouts, so that's a good thing because now you can throw the football in the middle of the field. If you didn't have those timeouts, you'd be more hesitant, you know, to do that. I have to have one timeout, but, you know, I think you have to be aggressive. I would like to get Dontavia Bogan down here at the bottom, matched up on a deep ball, one-on-one, let him go up and try and make a play.
Joel Miller there with him at the bottom of your screen. Daniels over the middle. Murray out of the backfield. Again, a first down to the 19. The clock will stop there as they move the chains. Daniels looks as if he wants to spike it again and does on first down. They only lose 3 seconds off the clock there, so an effective play from B.J. And now I think you look to the end zone.
You do, and I mentioned Dontavia Bogan. I think Stony Brook understood that's what South Florida's been trying to do. He had three defenders lined up in front of him. They had made sure he was not going to get an opportunity to get an easy, cheap touchdown.
Again, two receivers to the top and another pair down to the near side. Keep your eye on Andreas Shields.
Stony Brook, last time out of the half.
I think a wise timeout there by Coach Priore, making sure his defense is set and doesn't give away any freebies before the half. Why don't we take a look while we have a moment at the USF 2010 schedule. This is the first of a couple games we'll have for you here on Bright House Sports Network. Also looking forward to bringing you the October 2nd contest against FAU. And as we get into the league schedule there, the opener against Syracuse on the 9th. But what I really want to point to is look at that November schedule. They will only have to leave the state of Florida once when they go to Louisville, the other road trip to Miami. That goes well when you talk about Big East contest against Pitt and UConn. It could decide the league crown.
you know, they can get a little momentum going at the beginning of this year. I mean, they can maintain that streak of at least 8 wins during the season. You know, I think the last 5 years they've won at least 8 games. So, you know, if Skip Holtz, you know, inherits his program, understanding what they lost because of the National Football League, Carlton Mitchell, Jerome Murphy, Nate Allen, Jason Pierre-Paul, George Selva, they had a lot of guys move on to National Football League. To come in and not miss a beat, I think says a lot, because they'll continue to recruit better and better players.
Miller, Shields, and Bravo Brown to the right. Bogan all by himself to the top. Daniels with 11 seconds to go in the half. Time in the pocket, over the middle, looking for Miller. Joel Miller, touchdown. The junior out of Wharton High School makes good on that scholarship. How about it right before the half?
And you have to feel good for Joel Miller, understanding, you know, just being the center of everything that went on before the arrival of Coach Holtz. To see him on scholarship in this game, contributing to this program, it just have to feel good for the young man and his family.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, recognize that is a converted running back making a tumbling catch downfield in the end zone. Would have been a nice play even by a natural wideout. Extra point is through, and so it's 31-14 USF. Joel Miller has been working hard in practice to get those extra reps and make that transition.
What a throw by B.J. Daniels. Puts the right velocity on this ball, keeps it low so that backside safety can't get involved. Joel Miller goes down. For a running back, he can really catch the football. Like I said before, J.B., just really excited for that young man, to see him happy, to see him being an active and positive part of this program.
Bulls go 61 yards in 9 plays to score there before the half. While we have a moment, why don't we tell you about season tickets to see the USF Bulls in action in the future. 2010 tickets still available, in fact, for USF football. See the Bulls face the likes of Rutgers, Pittsburgh, Connecticut, and more of the teams we just showed you on the 2010 slate. Season tickets start as low as $75, a bargain to see this caliber of football. Call 1-800-GO-BULLS or go online to www.gousfbulls.com. One more time, www.gousfbulls.com. So with 6 seconds left, a low squib kick. Stony Brook, I believe, had a knee down, and they did. So that'll stop the clock with 3 seconds. And we'll see if Coach Priore takes a chance downfield or will settle for a knee in the halftime locker room.
You know, see, that's why I never got the opportunity to play special teams. Because if I was up back and they squibbed the kick, there's no way with 6 seconds left in the half of the kneeling down. I've been dreaming about returning a kick for a touchdown every night before the opener.
I would have liked your chances better from the 25 than I do for the Stony Brook offense right here. It looks like they will be content to go into the halftime locker room down 31-14. Well, they did take a touchdown lead in the USF Bulls' house. But the Bulls' defense, along with B.J. Daniels, turns the tables, and we'll go down to Vicky, who has Coach Holtz with her.
What do you think of B.J. Daniels' play on that final drive as Miller?
Showing a lot of poise as a quarterback. And as I told this team, he's always been athletic, but he's becoming a quarterback with athletic ability. Made some really good decisions, made a great throw there on the last play of the half.
Special teams, both sides of the ball, big plays.
This is, you know what, this is their first game. You know, the timeouts, the fumbled, holy smokes, we can catch a freaking punt. And we can't catch a punt. A lot of mistakes, but proud of the way they're competing.
All right, thanks, Coach.
Thank you, appreciate it.
Guys, back to you.
And thank you, Victoria. The halftime adjustments will be among the most interesting of the year, I think, in the break between our halves here in the first game of the Skip Holtz era. We'll be back with you in Tampa, J.B. Long and Sean King. Our halftime program right now, 31-14, USF on top as we go to half. USF on top, 31-14 after one half of play in Tampa. Let's go ahead and take a look at what else is going on around the Big East. And we'll start with a game that took place on Thursday. Do you have a chance to watch that Pittsburgh-Utah game out in the mountains? Tino Sinceri intercepted on that first play of overtime. 27-24, Utah hands Pittsburgh the first upset of the season.
Yeah, and the one thing you see is the Big East is not afraid to go out and schedule major opponents to open the season. You know, if I had a program, I wouldn't do it. I'd take the two cupcakes early in the season. But Pittsburgh, tough loss to Utah, Louisville loses to Kentucky, Connecticut. You know, Rich Rodriguez does a good job opening for Michigan. Looking at USF this year for the conference, they've got to find a way to run the football, to have balance offensive. You're going to have explosive plays in the passing game just because of B.J. Daniels. He's going to create those. They have to find a combination of Demetrius Murray, Mo Plancher, Bradley Battle, some kind of combination of those three guys where they can efficiently run the football, because this defense, although they're very fast, they are a little undersized. And so you have to find a way to keep them fresh into the fourth quarter.
Picked at the bottom half of the conference were the USF Bulls. We'll show you those rankings a little bit later on in the second half, but certainly in a wide-open conference, a chance for some upside for USF, led by one of the more experienced quarterbacks in the conference.
You're right, and you look around the conference, and outside of Zach Collaris at Cincinnati, a lot of teams breaking in new quarterbacks. I know Rutgers still has Tom Savage, but there's not a better player at the position than B.J. Daniels, and every head coach in America would tell you, if you have a quarterback that can play, you have a chance.
Quarterbacking and coaching, those are the two things that win in college football, and the Bulls feel like they have two of the best. We'll take another break here. When we come back, we had a chance to chat at length with Skip Holtz leading up to the season. We'll have that interview for you when we come back on Bright House Sports Network. 31-14, our halftime score. Bulls on top. B.J. Daniels has thrown two touchdown passes, one on USF's first offensive play, the last on their last, and the USF lead is 31-14 at the half. You know, one of the things that Coach Skip Holtz did to galvanize this team as he made the transition to a Holtz new era, as they're building it here at USF, is take the team across state to Vero Beach, off campus for training camp for 12 days, the first time that's been done in program history. Victoria Lim joins us from the sidelines now with more on the impact of that decision. Victoria.
Well, JB, when Coach Holtz did go across the state, he made big fans out of this family. Meet the Urbansics. This is Craig Urbansic, his son Cody, and his son Tyler. What made you decide to go and check out the USF Bulls?
Well, we live in Vero Beach, and they came down there, and my boys absolutely love football. So I had time off, so we tried to go down there as much as possible at Dodgertown to visit them.
And you were telling me that you really didn't know much about the Bulls, but after you met Coach Holtz, you became a season ticket holder?
Absolutely. I mean, he changed everything for us. He's dedicated to his team and his fans, and what better way to spend our Saturdays is here in Tampa.
And one thing about your family that really touched the whole team is your son, Cody. He's in remission right now from leukemia.
Yes. He's suffering from ALL, which is a form of leukemia, but he's in remission, and with the good Lord willing, we're doing very well right now with it.
Talk about the team and the coaches bonding with Cody. Talk about the team and the coaches bonding with Cody.
Oh, one day after before practice, Coach Holtz yelled Cody's name, and Cody raised his hand along with Tyler, and the whole team came over and just patted Cody on his head and high-fived both boys and chanted his whole name. And it was unreal. It brought tears to my eyes.
All right, Cody, what do you think about Coach Holtz?
He's nice, and he thinks about his fans.
And what did you like most about going to practice over there in Vero Beach?
Well, the best part was the autographs.
The autographs? What are the autographs you got?
Almost everybody.
Yeah? And who's your favorite player?
B.J. Daniels. And we like the other players, too. All
of course you like the other players, too. Why B.J. Daniels your favorite?
Because he's the quarterback.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Urbansic family. Welcome to Tampa. Hope you're enjoying yourself. JV, guys, back to you.
All right, and Cody, best wishes. Thanks for spending some time there. We talked about Coach Holtz being ambassador, not for the program, but for the university on the whole in our open. A perfect example right there of just that. Now, we had a chance to talk at length with Coach Holtz in anticipation of the 2010 season. Here's Mike Neighbors from The Neighborhood on Bright House Sports Network with that interview.
Well, here at USF, we have a brand new coach, and you know what? He's met the media quite a few times, but Skip Holtz, are you ready for the Neighborhood Nine?
I'm ready for the Neighborhood Nine. I've been looking forward to this. This is the one thing that I haven't done yet that I keep saying. I wonder when I'm going to get to do the Neighborhood Nine. So I'm excited to be here today.
We'll see if that's the case after the segment, though. All right, he's a media-savvy guy. Let's go right into it. Number one, if you could have dinner with football coaches, past or present, you guys could grill out, who would it be?
You know what? I think I've enjoyed having the opportunity to work with Bobby Bowden, Earl Bruce, and Lou Holtz. I've been very fortunate to work with some great coaches. For me, it's not a wish list of all these guys I wish I could have known or met and the Vince Lombardis, and that would be great. But I would love to have the opportunity to go back and just let Coach Bowden, Bruce, and Coach Holtz know just what impact they've had on my life as a coach.
Excellent answer. Let's go. Speaking of your dad, number two. You and your dad, a lot alike. You both are coaches. Right. You both are aggressive, very good with the media. How are you guys different?
I think probably in a lot of ways. I'm a lot like my mother in a lot of respects. But still, we're very similar. And I've said this before, I don't do something because Lou Holtz did it. But he is my father. In a lot of respects, we are extremely different. I'm probably a little more patient than him. I don't know if that's good or bad as a coach, but I'm probably a little bit more patient than him. My wife might disagree with that, but
you're patient to put up with me today. I appreciate that very much. Let's keep it within the Holtz family. Okay. Your name is Skip Holtz. You're a busy guy every day. If you could, pun intended, skip something right out of your normal routine, what would you skip?
Well, I certainly wouldn't skip the media. I mean, that's certainly not one of the things that I would skip. I love the football side of it, and I love dealing with the players. I've said this before, I've never gone to work a day in my life. I guess maybe some of the political things that you have to do, I could probably, you know, I don't get real excited about those type of things. But, you know, it's all part of what we do. We have to promote the program. We sit in the driver's seat, so to speak, of the football program, and there are a lot of different roles that we have to play. But I enjoy the roles that we do as a head coach.
All tight spirals so far. We're rolling here. If you could pick up any player in his prime in college football history to add to the Bulls roster this year, who would it be?
Oh my gosh. Am I limited to one?
You got to have one. I told you it wasn't easy. You got to have one. Yeah.
If I had to limit it to one, names coming to mind, Jerome Bettis, Ricky Waters, Rick Meyer, Chris Johnson. You got me excited. See, you got me salivating. I could add some of these guys to our team. I'm getting excited about this question.
I already thought the marketing campaign, the Bulls bus, Bettis. I mean, it was rolling off the tip of your tongue there, wasn't it?
I like the Bulls bus. Jerome would be a great addition. I'd love to have him.
All right, number five, speaking of the Bulls, I know you like movies. Your favorite sports movie, Bull Durham or Raging Bull?
Well, you know what? My favorite sports movie, I'd have to say was Rudy.
No, for the two Bulls, though. You got to pick out of the Bulls.
Yeah. I'd go with Bull Durham. Bull Durham. I'd go with Bull Durham. Although Raging Bull was a good one as well, but I'd go with Bull Durham.
You tried to go off Notre Dame there for me for a little while, didn't
you,
Rudy?
You know what? It wasn't just the Notre Dame, but when that movie was made, and I tell you what was so interesting, Rudy lived across the street, and so why they were making the movie, you could make a movie of what he went through to have the movie made. And he would bring the transcript over as they were writing it. And so we got a chance to read it before it was ever in film. And then when they were filming it on campus, my wife would go with them to a lot of the scenes. So we watched that movie made. And then to see it and, you know, to come together, to see the big picture, knowing where it started, that's one of the things that makes that movie so rewarding for me.
All right, forget the Bulls. We'll go back to Rudy. You sold me. You sold me on that. Number six. Your pet peeve, and I'm not talking about football, I mean in life. I mean the guy with the blinker in the left-hand lane, I mean, is there a pet peeve for Skip Holtz?
Pet peeve is people that are not motivated. I don't like the chilling mentality. I think we're all here for a purpose with something to do, and that's probably one of my pet peeves is people that are on cruise control.
Great answer. Number seven. We're going to get a little introspective here.
Okay.
We're on the couch. Dr. Phil moment for us.
Mike Nabors there with Coach Holtz at halftime. USF in front 31-14. We will have halftime statistics and more when we come back here on Bright House Sports Network. Welcome back to Raymond James Stadium. The Bulls on top at halftime 31-14. And here in the booth, J.B. Long with Sean King. Let's take a look at our first half stats, and I'll get your thoughts along the way. It started about as promising as it can for the Bulls. First play from scrimmage, Dontavia Bogan.
Hey, forget the entree. The appetizer is enough. Check, please. One catch, one touchdown. But special teams has been an issue. Have placed the football on the ground a couple times, but just like all good teams, are able to overcome adversity. Stony Brooks tried to hang in there. Actually had the lead after this nice throwing catch. But you know what, South Florida, if they're going to progress and be a part, of the Big East picture this year, it'll be because of this man right here. As good as there is in America, B.J. Daniels.
A rushing touchdown there. He also threw for two. But how about Chris Lane on special teams coming through with the block and then the recovery, a huge momentum shift for the Bulls. It gave them a little bit of comfort, and then you saw the offense start to click before the half. B.J. Daniels, 12 of 19 in the first 30 minutes. Joel Miller there on the receiving end. So that's how we got to this point, 31-14. Overall, your thoughts?
Well, I just thought very impressed by USF ability to overcome adversity. A lot of times, you know, that first game without a preseason game, without a primer, you're going to make mistakes, but they fought through it. I think they're poised to have a breakout second half.
All right, we'll see how much they can clean it up. Coming out of the locker room when we come back, some first half stats on the way for you too. Set to kick off the second half here in Tampa with USF in front 31-14 on Stony Brook. Before we do a quick look back at the stats from the first 30 minutes, and I think really what it shows is that USF had the better of the play on the field, but in special teams, a couple costly mistakes gave Stony Brook an early opportunity to put points on the board.
You know, and it allowed them to stay in the ball game, but, you know, eventually I think when you're USF, you know, you have more athleticism, more talent, more size, you're playing at home, your home opener. You know, that differential in talent generally starts to create what we have here, which is a comfortable halftime lead. But at the same time, South Florida, you know, they have their sights set on trying to win another Big East championship, and you can't do it with the penalties, with the turnovers. So they'll be trying to clean up their act a little bit in the second half.
And the Bulls will get the ball to start. The special teams shakeup continues. Kayvon Webster now to return the opening kick of the second half. He fields it at the eight. And brought down. Nice special teams play there by Brock Jakulski, one of the reserve running backs for Stony Brook, and a Hofstra transfer. So B.J. Daniels, after a very effective first half throwing the ball, 12 of 19, two touchdown tosses, and another one on the run. As you see Coach Holtz getting a word in there with Kayvon Webster, and ironing out those return duties will be a priority going to Gainesville next week.
And, JB, this is the drive for all offenses that I pay the most attention to. You've had an opportunity to get a feel for what they're doing. You've made your halftime adjustments. Can you come out and execute?
80 yards to go as they start from the 20, right up the middle, and a gain of 2.5 by Mo Plancher. Saw a little bit of everyone in the USF backfield in that first half. Demetrius Murray led the way with 34 yards rushing, but we saw Daniels on some carries. Mo Plancher, Bradley Battles actually got the start. It is a running back by committee in Tampa this fall. Coach Holtz barring or adapting a line from Bobby Bowden saying, if I don't have one great tailback, I'll settle for three good ones, basically, right? Or maybe said another way, if I have three good ones, I don't have one great one. Again, they go to the ground here, and I think they're intention to control the clock and the line of scrimmage here with the lead in the second half.
And I think also, you know, Coach Holtz wants to see this offensive line, you know, start to take control of this game. You know, when you talk about a position that had a lot of players returning with a lot of experience, you know, every member of this starting offensive line, you know, has started a game for the Bulls before. So he wants to see them come out and create that physical presence that they're going to need as the season moves on.
7 to go here from the 23. Daniels in the shotgun gets hit as he throws. Pass incomplete, intended for Bogan. As we check the backfield, B.J. Daniels doing just fine after being knocked to the turf by Jonas Rousseau. So the Bulls go 3 on out, their first offensive possession, and they'll have to punt it away.
And B.J. will be disappointed when he gets in the film room tomorrow. He had Lindsey Lamar wide open in the flat underneath for the first down. And a lot of times, you know, you want to make things happen, but, you know, like I said before, J.B., you know, Rich Rodriguez told me, never go broke taking a profit at quarterback.
Brockhaus-Khan gets it away. He's been utilizing a new grip on his drop, holding the football more like you would if you were to shake a hand. Said it's proven to be more effective for him so far in camp, and he gets that one over to the Stony Brook 40. That's where they'll start when we come back. Their first possession of the second half, 31-14, USF on top, just underway in the second half. We'll be right back. Welcome back to Tampa. J.B. Long and Sean King with you for Big East football on Bright House Sports Network. Stony Brook and USF, the Bulls in front 31-14. They go 3 and out in their opening drive of the first half. So now a little wildcat with Ed Gowans in the backfield for Stony Brook, and David Bedford sniffs it out dropped for a loss.
Good job of getting penetration, you know, through the line of scrimmage. Anytime you can make that running back start to try and elude defenders behind the line of scrimmage, that's just, you know, great and fantastic. As a defensive coordinator, you preach all week, get up the field, be aggressive, get to the football.
Gowans now assumes his running back duties with Coulter back under center on second and 13. They've been running the bootleg and they start with it here. The tight end Brett Arce makes the grab. Spun out of bounds, but not before he picks up four. Let's take a look at our quarterback comparison. True to form, Coulter's been completing about 50% of his passes. Now 7 of 13 on the game. B.J. Daniels, 12 of 19 in the first half. He did throw two touchdowns and picked up 196 yards. So, as we expected, Stony Brook, primarily a run-first team. B.J. Daniels has done a nice job picking his moments through the air.
And I thought he's been very efficient. And I think Mike Coulter from Stony Brook had a pretty impressive game also.
Now from the 42, heavy pressure right up the middle. And a sack. Keith McCaskill got in there, and the big fella just rolled over. 282, a junior from Tallahassee, his first career sack.
And you know, this kind of stuff here gives you nightmares at night, JB. Get hit like this. You can't sleep. You think Keith is coming into your bedroom when you get back.
Take a look at who's deep for the USF Bulls as they continue to juggle the punt return situation. T-Rex, Terrence Mitchell, a local product and heavily recruited prospect, awaits the punt. He'll have to retreat to his 20, angling towards the sideline, and T-Rex won't get the chance. A reserve defensive back, and Coach Holtz juggling whether or not to get him in the mix. We saw him there. We'll take a break as B.J. Daniels and the USF offense coming back for their second possession of the second half after this. Good look at new Bulls head coach Skip Holtz there, his 11th season as a head coach. He told his players coming in, hey, I chose to be here. I chose you. None of you chose me. So rather than make his guys prove themselves to him, although they have, he's worked to earn their respect. And B.J. Daniels and the offense back out on the field for their second drive of the first half after going three and out and a three wide set from the 20. Intended for Evan Landy, incomplete. Landy led the team with four receptions for 51 yards in the first half.
And something to watch, B.J., you know, seems to be maybe favoring his hamstring or his ankle or something. Maybe he might be a little tight. Doesn't look as fluid as he did in the first half.
Bo Plancher, the senior running back, to his left on second down. We'll tuck it down and now fire. Bogan makes the catch, picks up the first down, and is shoved out of bounds. So a good job by Daniels to keep that play alive and move the chains.
And I've been really impressed tonight with Dontavia Bogan. You know, here's a guy who, you know, came into this offseason, this training camp, not expecting to play. You know, they lose Carlton Mitchell last year. A.J. Love and Sterling Griffin, the top two wideouts from last year, both injured, not playing tonight. This is an opportunity for him to introduce himself to America. He's taking advantage of it. He's a big receiver. He's elusive. He has great top-end speed. You know, if I'm Coach Holtz, you know, I'm excited, you know, about this season with Bogan as one of my premier wideouts.
We shouldn't be surprised that Bogan and Daniels have been quite the pair tonight. In the spring game, they were terrific. Working with Daniels, Bogan caught nine balls for 228 yards and four scores, and they hooked up on the first play from scrimmage. Daniels using a variety of receivers and has done it with his feet as well. But back to the point on Bogan, even in that first series, after Matt Grothy went down last year with that injury, Bogan was the first. He caught the 50-yard touchdown from B.J. Daniels, so they've almost had that instant chemistry. And while there may have been some players ahead of him on the depth chart as we await the injured player, Bogan and Daniels have clicked right from the start. There is Almajid Hutchins, the junior, transfer from Rutgers, and the list of walking wounded continues to grow for Stony Brook here in the second half. Hutchins, a transfer from Rutgers. But a lot of the transfers this offseason for Stony Brook came from Hofstra as the Pride shut their program down in the offseason. A lot of those players looking to stay close to home, not have to move far, stay right there on Long Island and move over to the Stony Brook program. And you can see some of the impact that they're having on the depth chart. Jakolski, special teams contributor, has been an impact player. Of course, Reggie Franklin got the start at middle linebacker. He had to leave with an injury.
And you can make an argument that Miguel Masonette, you know, he had an outstanding, you know, couple of runs a couple times he's got an opportunity. You can make a case that, you know, moving forward for Stony Brook, he deserves a little more playing time.
Now a first down for Daniels from the 33. Fakes to Plancher. He wants it all. Evan Landy wide open down the seam. He makes the catch inside the 30. Only one man saved that from being a touchdown. Craig Richardson dropping to make the tackle. Otherwise, Landy had six.
Great play action by B.J. Daniels. He sees his guy wide open. You know, he does something that it looks so easy, but a lot of quarterbacks, right, that they try and make the perfect throw. He understands when a guy's open, the only way you can guarantee that it's incomplete is to overthrow or to throw it out of bounds. He throws it right to the face mask. Great play for South Florida in that offense.
Let me correct the tackle there by Anderson, the touchdown saving tackle. Now Daniels to the air again to the far side, reaching behind to make the catch. Bogan flashing the hands, another first down.
And JB, this is an unbelievable catch. I mean, this is Randy Moss, Terrell Owens, Calvin Johnson type talent that Bogan is putting on tape tonight. I mean, he's making a case that, you know, the first team Big East at receiver position, you know, may be up for grabs. I mean, a guy his size that has the ability to pluck the football, you can always use a lot of those guys.
Gain of 14. Ball now spotted at 12. Again to throw Daniels. A little pump fake looking for Landy. There's a flag, and that'll be pass interference as Landy had a step, and Anderson had no choice but to make contact and prevent the touchdown.
Pass interference, 39 defense. Ball be placed at the spot of the foul. First down.
Again, Dennis Hennigan heads our officiating team out of the Big East. And another chance for the Bulls in the red zone where they were so effective last year. And so many options when B.J. Daniels is your quarterback. Go to the I formation here with Kelly ahead of Plancher. Bogan and Landy the receivers. Four on the snap count for Daniels. They'll run right. Plancher looking for the pylon. Touchdown, Plancher. Touchdown, USF. The 12th touchdown of Plancher's career. The senior from Naples gets in.
A good job on the edge by the fullback. Richard Kelly, which really allowed and what sprung Mo Plancher to the pylon. You know, everyone knows Mo Plancher. I call him Sweet Feet. You know, he definitely has the ability to push the gas pedal and turn those miles per hour up a few notches when needed.
The drive took just 147 to go 80 yards in five plays. The completion to Landy was key. A couple nice throws to Bogan as well. And then Plancher, the capper. Fullback Kelly out there with a block. Plancher started all 13 games a year ago and was a captain. But as you know, when you can't contribute in camp, there are players anxious to get at your position. And that was indeed the case with Bradley Battles, who really impressed the coaching staff and earned the start here tonight. I think Plancher not only got the hit that Coach Skip Holtz was looking for going to Florida next week, but also a little bit of confidence, perhaps, in his running ability and his health.
And I think this second half is important for this Bulls team because, you know, winning is all about execution. Even though they're winning with a halftime lead, they didn't necessarily execute at the level that I'm sure that they expect to. So this second half gives you an opportunity to fine-tune some things that could continue well on this machine so that, you know, when you go to Gainesville next week, you have a chance to pull an early season upset, just like last year when you went to Tallahassee and no one gave you a chance and you walked out of Doak Campbell with a victory.
Best kick of the night for Bonani. He sends Jukolski back to the goal line. Running left. Kayvon Webster got a hand on him, and he completes the tackle with some help from his friends. Webster with a special teams play there. And Stony Brook will start at the 23. I think if the coaching staff had it their way, they would like Plancher, the veteran, to establish himself as their first guy. Be the guy that gets the first carry, takes the first hit in big situations like they'll see next week at the Swamp, because they can trust his experience.
Well, they know what they have there. They have enough tape on him. You know, they know what he can do, you know, when the bright lights come on. And, you know, it gives you a comfort level as a play caller and as a coach.
Gowans right up the middle. That's Sam Barrington and others. Barrington played in all 13 games as a freshman and recorded 41 tackles. Drew Praise, you see Sabbath Joseph in there. Both those reserve linebackers will rotate through consistently as we've seen tonight. Barrington, another one of those guys that had a lingering shoulder injury in addition to some legal trouble in the offseason related to some driver's license violations. And he missed time, and some other guys stepped up and took advantage, but certainly a key portion of that center defense. He'll continue to contribute as the year goes on.
And they're going to need all 11 of those guys at some point to step up and play their part.
Coulter on play action. Blitz coming. Does get it away, but it's intercepted. The second interception of the game. This one goes to David Bedford. How about that defensive end dropping into the flats?
You know, I had talked to Rick Smith, who was actually the coordinator at Tulane the year we went undefeated, and he said one of the things that they're going to try and do a little bit this year is do a little zone blitz. That's where you blitz a linebacker, drop a defensive end in the pass coverage. You see the linebacker gets there, puts pressure on the quarterback, and what about your defensive lineman being able not just bat the ball down but catch the interception? You've got to love that.
So already on top, 38-14. A chance for USF to provide the dagger, and they've made a quarterbacking change. We get our first look at the freshman Bobby Eveld under center. And he'll throw it out to his fellow walk-on, Stephen Bravo Brown. How about that, the connection? And I'll tell you what, from watching practice, I know about the chemistry between these two. They stay after practice and throw pass after pass to each other. It's nice having a fellow walk-on and a freshman to put in the extra time with you, Sean.
It is, and you have to be proud of Bobby Evil. He's from right down the street at Jesuit High School. I mean, he could walk to his class last year if he wanted to. And to come in, and, you know, they had a very, very highly, you know, rated quarterback that they brought in, and he's leapfrogging, and right now they're comfortable with him as a backup if something would happen to B.J. Daniels.
Murray gets the carry to the 25, and then some stacked up there. Coach Holtz tells a great story about Bobby Eveld. We told you how they spent some time over in Vero Beach, a dozen days over there for training camp, and they would give their guys a break to get some food and a quick nap in the afternoon. This kid Eveld just kept throwing and throwing and throwing. He set up trash cans with no teammates around him just to get that extra work in.
We got
to
get Bobby a girlfriend. But you love to see that. You love to see kids that are willing to do whatever it takes to get better.
From the shotgun now. Swings it out to Murray with blockers in front of him. Cuts it at the 20. Still on his feet. Murray could go. Dives for the pylon. Touchdown, Demetrius Murray. And how about a nod to Bobby Eveld, too? His first collegiate drive. How about the stat? A touchdown pass.
2 for 2 and a touchdown. You can't beat that.
Look at the blocking out in front. Jamar Bass.
See, now, JB, if he never plays again, he says, you know, hey, when I was in college, I completed every pass and threw a touchdown every other pass.
What a moment for Bobby Eveld and Demetrius Murray, too. His first touchdown. And the extra point is through. So they capitalize on an interception once again, and USF pulling away here in the third quarter. 45-14, Eveld to Murray, and the pylon for the score. .14 on the board for the Bulls in the third quarter, and Bobby Eveld leads a touchdown drive in his first appearance in the green. And some congratulatory handshakes there on the sideline. I'm sure, Sean, you can think back to your first touchdown drive.
I can. You know, I'm sitting here, you know, happy for Bobby Evo, but also at the same time, I remember when I was BJ Daniels, you know, one of the things that I would do, JB, is I'd tell coach before the game, listen, I'm not coming out.
I think Daniels would have a hard time making that case, given how important he is to this club. The return from Jakulski nearly got loose. D.D. Lattimore swung him down, may have saved a score. There is a flag. We'll see who it goes against.
During the return, holding number 19 of the return team, 10-yard penalty, first down.
So it was coming back anyway, still a nice tackle by Lattimore. Let's go down to the sideline now and check in with Victoria Lim.
Bobby Evelt, hometown product from Jesuit High School, talked to his former high school coach, Joe Ross, said that Bobby Evelt was a workhorse, that he made sure that he was the first one on the field and the last one to leave the field. He wasn't surprised that he got the walk-on backup starting spot, or backup spot rather, behind BJ Daniels. And he says out of his 33 years, Joe Ross says that Bobby Evelt is his top one or two player who he's ever coached. Back to you.
Certainly high praise there, and Evelt won that backup job. Taking it away from Jemias Gunsby, heavily recruited player out of Georgia. Suffered a little bit of a hip flexor injury and had some trouble. And when you're just learning the system, especially each moment loss, much less practice loss, sets you further and further behind in terms of competing for a job.
And it's a big adjustment for some of these kids, you know. You know, Bobby didn't have to leave home. He lived here in Tampa. He has his comfort zone. You know, Gunsby's come from Georgia. A lot of times kids, you know, encounter homesickness. You just never know. But you know, if watching Bobby Evil have success tonight doesn't motivate Gunsby to get his act together, I don't know what will.
Saw Coach Peter Voss there, the quarterback's coach. He has all kinds of experience in the pro ranks to his time at Notre Dame and elsewhere, working with Daniels and Evel. Pass into the flat is complete to Gush. He picks up the first down and is crunched at the 30. I asked Coach Voss this week in preparation for the game what keys he'll be looking for in his quarterbacks, and especially B.J. Daniels, and he actually had a pretty simple answer. I like my quarterbacks to smile. When they're smiling, I know they're comfortable and they've got command of the situation. And I said, yeah, Coach, when they're smiling, that also means they're not throwing interceptions, right?
Hey, I don't know. I would test that out one game. I threw a pick, I'd come up to Coach Voss just smiling.
A sheepish smile, huh? I'm sure Evelt's smiling down there on the sideline as he chats with Daniels. And Gowans gets the carry. Gets five left side. Kayvon Webster there to cover the corner.
And that run right there, you can just tell why Edwin Gowans has had success in his career. You know, they're down, they're behind, but he's still running hard. He's still fighting for every yard. That says a lot about Chuck Priore and his team. You know, they're coming down here, you know, in a very tough situation against a very good football team. And you know what they're saying? You know, we're going to continue to execute, continue to work on what we do and get better so that we get in our Big South schedule, we have a chance to be successful.
See Julius Forte down there, the end of the near side of the defensive line for the Bulls. Pass is tipped in the air. Another chance for an interception there, and it is picked off. Going the opposite way, the freshman, Mark Joyce. Welcome to USF. Touchdown, Bulls. Joyce, heavily recruited out of DeLand High School. Coach Holtz said he was a lock to play. There was never a thought to redshirt this kid at the safety position. An impact player. It goes off the helmet of the defensive lineman. It looked like that was Anthony Hill. So an assist to Hill's helmet and a touchdown for Joyce. I'm sure that'll come out to dinner in the dining hall at some point along the way.
At least a free juice.
Point after is good by Eric Schwartz. He's been money on those all night long, and the lead swells to 52-14. Back up the moment for Bobby Evelt with this one for another true freshman, Joyce. Those are the ones you dream of as a defensive back.
And, you know, it just really, you know, gets you excited about the long-term stability of the program. You know, you come out, your veterans, your guys with experience, you know, they've performed admirably tonight. You know, now you insert your second string guys, you insert some of your younger players, and they continue to make plays, and that gets you excited.
Victoria Lim has a special guest down on the field.
This guy is going to be pretty familiar to USF fans, and he's now to the NFL fans. Jason Pierre-Paul, welcome back to Tampa.
Thank you. It's been pretty good being back in Tampa, my hometown, you know.
Drafted by the Giants, how are you liking it?
I'm liking it pretty well. No, I'm just pretty quickly in the NFL. You know, I thought it was going to be harder, but it ain't at all.
It's not harder. You think that's because of all the conditioning that you got here at USF?
Yeah, and up there too, you know. But things are pretty fast in the NFL, but I'm adjusting pretty quickly, so you know, things are going to be all right for me.
So what is it like for you to come back here? You liking what you see on the field?
Yeah, defense is handling their thing out here, man. I like it, you know. Thought it was going to be a little tough, but they doing their thing out here, you know. I'm proud of them.
Have you had a chance to meet Skip Holtz?
Yeah, I met him way back before I came back. I came back a couple of times. I met him, and he's a pretty good coach, man. Cares about his players a lot.
All right, thank you so much. Congratulations. Good luck. Nice to meet you.
Thank you.
JB, back to you.
Thank you, Victoria. Jakulski on the kick return. Out across the 20, and the Bulls converge on him there, shoved out of bounds before he reaches the 30. And the radio analyst, Mark Robinson, in here before the game. We were chatting with him, and Pierre-Paul was one of his favorite players to watch last year, and his footwork is what he was so complimentary of.
Yeah, he has unbelievable athleticism for a man his size. And the sky's the limit for him from a potential standpoint. But, you know, I did catch a little bit of what he said, JB, and he said it's been easy so far. You know, he might be fooled. I hope we get a chance to interview him about mid-November when he's been having to defend the power O for 10 weeks.
How tough to transition at the defensive end position? Is that one of the more difficult places to make an impact in your career?
It really is, especially to develop into a very well-rounded guy that can play the run and rush the passer. You know, those grown men are coming at you. They're blocking. They're cutting. You know, those backs are continually riding your shoulder pads. You know, it takes a strong man to continue to line up every play and give it all he's got.
And it took about four men on the Bulls side of the football to run Miguel Masonette out of bounds. And speaking of Mark Robinson, he will be our analyst Tuesdays at 1 p.m. here on Bright House Sports Network, the Skip Holtz Show. We will carry Coach's press conference live at the top of the hour, have some player profiles, coordinator interviews, and we'll break it down with Mark Robinson. The Skip Holtz Show live every Tuesday at 1 p.m. in high definition, Bright House Sports Network, cable channel 1147. Look forward to getting Coach Holtz's thoughts on this one this coming Tuesday, and also look ahead to an incredibly exciting contest against the Florida Gators. The throw downfield incomplete, intended for Jakulski. And I know you caught a little bit of that Florida Gators game on television this afternoon before making your way to the stadium.
I did.
The snap, I think, will be a focal point.
Yeah, you know, a lot of times, JB, you know, win or lose, you know, after the coaches evaluate the film, you know, they break down who had how many errors. You're getting what you call a trust circle. And based on the amount of missed assignments and errors, you have to do what you call up-downs. And I could imagine that practice will be a little longer than usual tomorrow up in Gainesville.
Mike Pouncey, I think, has a few up-downs coming his way, if today was any indication. A sloppy start for the Gators, and they never really got the wheels fully in motion. I don't know if that's good news or bad news for the Bulls going up there next week. I think the good news is the Gators look vulnerable. The bad news is they look vulnerable in week one.
Yeah, but I think if you're South Florida, you're not worried about the Gators, good or bad. You know, it's all about you and your ability to execute, and I think that's why the second half is important. You know, even though they have a lead, you know, this is still preparation, you know, for the remainder of their season. And, you know, if you want to go into Gainesville, if you want to get a win, you know, not lose close. I mean, leave, you know, with a victory. You can have to execute at an extremely high level.
Third and nine for Coulter. He will throw. Looking left. Pass deflected at the line of scrimmage. Credits Julius Forte with the pass breakup there. Nice work at the line of scrimmage on the push. And Stony Brook will have to punt.
And as we saw Victoria interview Jason Pierre-Paul, you know what a dynamic pass rusher that he was. You know, everyone thought there was going to be a big drop-off, you know, along that defensive front, you know, and with South Florida's ability to get pressure on the opposing quarterback. But tonight, I mean, if you ask Michael Coulter, the quarterback from Stony Brook, mm-hmm. he probably would think that George Selvey, Jason Pierre-Paul, those guys still play for South Florida because he's been under duress the entire night.
Terrence Mitchell again hoping to get a chance to return his first punt. You can see his frustration there, snapping his hands as it goes out of bounds once again. 25-yard line will be the field position for the Bulls. As Mitchell jogs off, why don't we introduce you to some of the new Bulls, those we haven't met already. Of course, the pick six by Mark Joyce. He's joined by several four-star and three-star players. Todd Chandler, defensive tackle. He'll get a redshirt year. Terrence Mitchell. Claude Davis, defensive end. May get a look at him here as the moments drip away. Of course, Bobby Evell back under center. And he gives the handoff to Bradley Battles on first down. Gain of four. I think recruiting-wise, Skip Holtz here has a lot to offer. And I can't imagine he wouldn't win many living rooms with his personality and charisma.
And you know, I've had the opportunity to get to know Coach Holtz, you know, over the last couple of years, being a former Conference USA guy myself. You know, we've crossed paths quite a lot. And, you know, he's just one of those guys, he gets it. You know, he grew up under his dad. You know, and everybody's met Coach Holtz, you know, Lou Holtz. You know,
false start, 89 offense, 5-yard penalty, second down.
That's Dr. Lou to you, Sean.
Yeah, Dr. Lou. That's a great segment. But everybody's met him. You know, he's had such an endearing personality. You know, they say the apple doesn't fall far from the tree. And Skip, you know, takes a lot of the characteristics and attributes that his father has, and he uses them. And, you know, I think he gets it. He understands that for South Florida to be successful, to compete on the highest levels, they have to do a good job of locking down Central Florida, letting UF and Miami and Florida State know if you're going to come Tampa, Orlando, Bradenton, all the surrounding areas and get kids, you're going to have to go through us.
This kid, Stephen Bravo Brown, is going to be a fan favorite in no time. Another nice catch there on the delivery from Eveld. And the producer, Chris McCauley, rightly points out after that last penalty, USF, for all their hiccups along the way in this first game, they have not been heavily penalized, and almost all of the flags against them have been procedural. Simply lining up, those mistakes are bound to happen in week one. But just four flags for 25 yards for a team that suffered almost 60 yards of penalties per game back in 2009. And a great look at Stephen Bravo Brown. With a name like that, you got to be a good football player, right?
False start, 89 offense, 5-yard penalty. First down.
And Chris McCauley,
I was going to say,
our producer, doesn't he know that's the kiss of death?
You know, I wanted to get his name out there to give him some credit, but instead I think I exposed him to some criticism.
Yeah, Chris, stay in the truck, be quiet.
Better in a 52-14 game. Farron Horns getting a look at wide receiver now, all the way to the bottom of your screen. He waves Lindsey Lamar over as well to join Andreas Shields. Evelt in the shotgun. Swings it out to Lamar. The speedster with some room to run. Stops at the 50. Caught from behind by Aaron West. The safety recovering to make the play, but not before Lindsey Lamar gets a nice gain. Set up second and short. Three or four.
And this is good to see. You know, JB, one of the concerns coming into the season was, you know, didn't the University of South Florida have the skill guys necessary to compete at the highest levels of college football? And Lindsey Lamar, you know, Stephen Bravo Brown, they've started to showcase some of this potential, you know, as the game has moved on.
Now Battles gets a carry. Flashing forward. He lost the ball. It's loose, and it looked like Stony Brook got it. As Battles fought for extra yardage, he lost control of the football, and that will be a USF turnover. I think one of the things that Coach Priore will take away from this trip to Tampa, if nothing else, is the tenacity that his defense played and hit with, jarring some balls loose from USF ball carriers.
And you know, the impressive thing to me is, you know, I love what Skip Holtz just did. You know, you have a young man in Bradley Battles. He was a starter in tonight's game, kind of been overshadowed by Murray, overshadowed by Plancher, gets in the game, wants to make something happen. Skip pulls him to the side. Listen, I'm not upset with you. The other guys had some momentum. We rode that momentum. I still believe in you. You don't have to go out and try and prove anything. Take care of the football.
Gowans with a nice sidestep to get to the outside and pick up six. Do want to mention on the previous play, Craig Richardson, the man to snap it out for Stony Brook. Controlling Gowans, one of the keys we mentioned at the outset, and I think the Bulls have done an impressive job keeping him under wraps. That his 10th
personal
carry.
Foul, face mask, number 26 defense, 15-yard penalty, first down.
And that'll be a first down for Stony Brook. But to finish the thought, Gowan's 10 carries, 29 yards for a guy who's over 2,000 in his two-year career at the FCF level. Nice job by that USF defense.
Yeah, and this is a difficult defense, you know, to run against, you know, especially East and West. And a lot of his carries tonight have been carries where he's trying to get to the edge. And South Florida just has so much team speed, it's very difficult to get that accomplished.
Sabbath Joseph, the linebacker, up to the line of scrimmage on the strong side. They'll go to the up back, and it's Gallants. Gets to the second level and moves the chains once more. And that should do it for our third quarter of play. A good one for the USF Bulls.
That is the end of the third quarter.
Thank you, Dennis. They hold Stony Brook scoreless in that third frame and expand their lead to 52-14. USF comfortably in front here as we start the fourth quarter. The youngsters enjoying the Skip Holtz era, getting off on a good foot. And the goal here in the fourth quarter, I think twofold. One, you'd like to keep Stony Brook out of the end zone, preferably, but stay healthy, stay healthy, stay healthy in the final 15 minutes. Pitch left, Jakulski. Patrick Hampton beat him to the corner. No gain on the play. Bulls defense pitched a shutout in the third quarter. And I think they played a really nice game. Were it not for some drastic field position changes, it would have been interesting to see how much the offense for Stony Brook could have mustered. I think some nice play in the secondary. Certainly the defensive line has gotten pressure, Sean, throughout the evening. Here's Masonette. Close to the first down as he spins away. And I believe he got it inside the 10-yard line. That'll set up a first and goal.
And as a coaching staff, you know, you're always evaluating. You're always trying to identify, you know, players who, you know, you can put into your offensive scheme. And Miguel Masonette, every time he's gotten the opportunity to run the football tonight, I mean, he's looked pretty impressive.
Some of the new defensive backs into the ballgame. We've talked about George Baker, Tyson Butler, junior corner in there as well. From the nine, Masonette dances at the line, met in the hole by Sabbath Joseph. Excuse me, that was Weatherspoon in there on the tackle. Sam Barrington enjoying some playing time as well. Good hit in the hole there by Barrington, sophomore out of Jacksonville. Previous coaching regime described him as the best freshman linebacker in USF history. Lofty praise for number 36.
And that's a high compliment. You know, but if you see, you know, his discipline right now with their run fits, you know, in run defense, JB, everybody's responsible for a gap. If you overrun that gap, then the cutback's available. He was right where he's supposed to be. Disciplined linebacker, made the tackle.
Coulter on second and goal. Pressured heavily. Throws it to the end zone. Picked off by Baker. Another interception for the Bulls. And an assist to Luke Sager, bringing the heat in the backfield. Baker comes away with the pick.
You know, and Baker gets credit for the interception, but this is because of the pressure. Mike Coulter has been under pressure the entire night. He's probably going to the sideline like, coach, they have to be playing with 13 or 14 guys. It seems like South Florida defensive linemen are everywhere.
Well, Linares got the first. Joyce returned one for a touchdown, and now Baker gets in on the interception party. And mission accomplished as the Bulls turn away the Stony Brook offense once more here in the second half. And I think Coach Holtz pleased with the second half adjustments that his team has made across the board. Uveld now on the pitch. And a nice run by Marcus Shaw. Loses control at the end. Fortunate that it goes right into the waiting hands of Jeff Hawkins, backing up the play nicely. Our first look at Marcus Shaw, freshman from Arcadia. Shaw, a top 50 running back recruit out of high school, and we saw a flash there. Look at the coach put an arm around his youngster and say, hey, the first part I love, the end not so much.
And he's just making a point. He understands that as the competition gets better, you're just not going to be able to put the football on the ground. If you think South Florida's fumbled the football five or six times tonight, and you're going to lose ball games, you know, against good teams when you do that.
Eveld this time hands off to Murray. Demetrius on first down. Gets to the second level and nearly breaks away. Spun down outside the 35-yard line. A nice pickup to move the chains by Demetrius Murray. Roosevelt Kirk saved the day for Stony Brook.
And great vision by Demetrius Murray. You see him, he's following his blocks, he's making good cuts. And the thing I like is you see that ball is secure. Even though he's in traffic, he's got that ball right next to his body, so if someone takes a swipe at it, he doesn't lose control of it.
Nine carries for 56 yards and a good average per as well. Eveld to throw now. Hits T.J. Knowles, our first chance to call his number. Knowles, a redshirt sophomore, a JUCO transfer. He'll have 3 years of eligibility here at USF. And another big target, 6 foot six. Those are the frames you look for as a quarterback, I'm sure.
Well, the good thing about those guys, it's hard to throw a bad pass. You get those tall receivers, you know, with those long wingspans. Yeah, they make you look good.
Margin for error.
Yeah, and, you know, I know South Florida has a comfortable lead, but, you know, I'd like to see Bobby throw the football down the field a little bit. I want to see his arm, you know, see if he can locate the football, get him a couple aggressive play calls.
Marcus Shaw comes back with a vengeance. Hard running there to pick up the first down on short yardage. How about Eveld? Four of his first four. No nerves on the young freshman's part.
And he's done a really good job. All been safe throws. I want to see him open it up a little bit, you know, let the young man get down the field, you know, so he can upload the video tonight and show all his friends everywhere.
Not sure he'll get it in a 52-14 game, but all things being equal, we'll see what Eveld can do. Now 5 of 5. Hand off there to Shaw. Wrapped up nicely from behind. Alex Probasco on the tackle, and Lalo Prado there, skipper of the baseball team. Looking forward to his new facility. I drove by the baseball site the other day. The athletic program really working in the right direction here. New facilities across the board. You know the recruits, they like new.
New is good.
Eveld, again throwing at the line of scrimmage. Shaw catches it nicely out of the backfield. So a good dynamic there from the freshman back. We've seen him carry with some speed. Appeared very comfortable carrying out of the backfield as well on the catch.
And you have to be impressed with Eveld's accuracy. You know, he's really doing a good job of locating the football. You know, that's so important at the QB position. That you give receivers, running backs an opportunity when they catch the football to immediately get into attack mode.
Under center now on first down in Stony Brook territory. Roosevelt Kirk swallows up the back on the tackle. Let's go down to Victoria Lim. And, Vicky, you had a chance to talk with both quarterbacks this week. How are they getting along?
Well, JB, Bobby Eveld told me that B.J. Daniels had a lot to do with him being prepared to take this backup position. He says that B.J. has helped him be able to read defenses better and also keep his composure, because at one time B.J. was kind of thrown into the fire very early on, and look how he did. Back to you.
He sure was. Started last season as a decisive number two. Obviously, Matt Grothy returning as the most accomplished quarterback in USF history. But in one play, your season can change. Shaw with another nice grab out of the backfield, down to the 30 and out of bounds there. Say two things about the screen pass. One, the backs look comfortable catching the ball out of the backfield, and the linemen really doing a nice job getting downfield to block on these screen passes.
Yeah, they're doing a very good job of executing all those passes. You know what jumps out to me, JB, is the depth on this South Florida team. You know, Shaw is about the fifth running back that we've seen tonight, and they've all had flashes of just having extreme ability. You look at the wide receiver position, you know, Bogans played well, Landy played well, Bravo Brown, Lamar. You know, maybe the demise of this South Florida program might have been a little exaggerated.
Derek Hopkins, another freshman receiver in the formation, and there is Isaac Virgin. Lost his lid at the 10, but not before he makes the grab, a pickup of 20. And Virgin, a redshirt freshman, converted high school quarterback, catching on at the tight end.
Great catch, but watch this throw by Evan Lent, by Bobby Evell. And one thing I had mentioned I wanted to see was him throw the football down the field. You know, I'm impressed. You know, Marquell Blackwell, who's probably the most decorated quarterback that's played in South Florida, I mean, he was ranting and raving about how good he thinks Bobby Evell will be, you know, once B.J. Daniels moves on.
Still perfect on the night. Out of the shotgun here. Flag on the play.
False start, number 66 offense, 5-yard penalty, first down.
That'll back the Bulls up to the 15. We should note that they've dropped the chain, so it'll set up a first and goal situation from the 15. And just back to Virgin quickly. Todd Fitch said, you know, you just can't recruit enough players like Isaac Virgin. 6'4", almost 250 pounds, can run down the seam as we just saw. They can split him out as a wideout if they need to. Play a little H-back, tight end. A lot of versatile big men. That pass tipped away. So the first incompletion finally for Bobby Evell. Alex Probasco on the pass breakup.
Hey, you know who Evell reminds me of? He reminds me of Tony Pike. But I think he has a little better arm than Pike. Seems like he has a little more velocity than Pike did. But he has that same build. Tall, you know, slender. You know, definitely could use, you know, a couple steaks, you know, a couple extra nights in the weight room. But, you know, you just think about, you know, him maturing, you know, to 2-3 years down the line from now. You know, that is a great thing for South Florida, because now you don't necessarily have to go out and recruit a quarterback. You can use that scholarship for other positions.
Tried to swing it out to Shaw. That pass overthrown. Looked like he rushed that one just a bit. 7:20 and counting here in the fourth quarter. USF obviously with the wide margin. B.J. Daniels left the game in the third quarter after going 15 of 22 for 264 yards.
You know, these guys haven't made. When I was drafted by the Bucks in 99, we didn't have, you know, the fans on the side blowing out the cold air. We just had to sit there in the heat and suffer.
I saw you looking down at those. Evell evades the pressure. Had Sean the flat, would have been six. Just missed his intended target, and looks like a field goal upcoming for USF. Well, Evell started so hot, stalled out there in the red zone. There is a flag on the play. Looks like they'll pick it up, and instead out to attempt the field goal, Eric Schwartz. Schwartz and Benani waged a place-kicking battle throughout training camp. When we left on Thursday, it still had not been decided. He delivers the boot here and missed wide right. So we'll take a break here. USF still on top, 52-14 after a nice drive. Captain by Evell. We'll be back with Stony Brook football after this. B.J. Daniels, a big smile as his night is done. USF on top, 52-14. As he so often does, Daniels getting it done on the ground and through the air. It'll be Stony Brook football. First and 10 from their own 20. Mike Coulter, the starter, continues to work. Handoff goes to Jakulski. Met nicely in the hole there. Weatherspoon in at linebacker now, and we get a look at Claude Davis, a junior from Lakeland, at defensive end as well. We've referenced the Big East poll and expectations throughout the broadcast. There you see USF picked sixth by the voting members. Sean, your response?
Well, I think they'll have a chance to outplay, you know, that preseason ranking. A lot of times in the preseason, you rank teams based on, you know, who's returning and who departed. And when you look at what USF lost, you know, having five guys selected in last year's draft, you know, the perception is going to be there's going to be a little drop-off. But, you know, you look at the depth, you look at the talent that's on this team, and that's not necessarily true.
Coulter to throw on second and 9. They'll rule it a completion, but only for a yard. And now the umpire comes in and does wave it off. One of the things in the storylines to watch in the Big East this season is certainly going to be the turnover at the head coaching position. Obviously, Skip Holtz here at USF, but Butch Jones also takes over for Brian Kelly at Cincinnati as the defending champions. They're getting a late start out west in Fresno tonight. Charlie Strong lost his opener to Kentucky at Louisville. How about that? Welcome to Kentucky. Here's a rivalry game right out of the chutes.
Right off the bat.
Joker Phillips as well. Jakolski again on the run.
And I'm sure Charlie still had his game plan notes from when he was at Florida. You know, he just looked out there and didn't see Joe Hayton and Brandon Spikes and Carlos Dunlap and all those guys that executed.
Weatherspoon and the Bulls get a stop on third down. Been impressed with the two-time JUCO All-American, Weatherspoon. Junior from St. Petersburg. See if Terrence Mitchell can finally get one between the hash marks or at least something that he can return. Highly touted freshman, really the first major recruiting victory for Skip Holtz when he arrived. Got Terrence Mitchell out of Hillsborough High. Took him away from the likes of Florida State and Florida. And Claude Davis nearly blocks the punt, got through. And how about that? Finally one to return for Mitchell, and he has to call for a fair catch. So a good boot. Takes USF right to their own 30-yard line. We'll take a break here. 5:17 left to go in the opening win for Skip Holtz and the Bulls. Good look at the band here at USF. Holding strong in a 52-14 affair in favor of their Bulls. And there is Terrence Mitchell, fielded the last punt on a fair catch. And Sean, for a team that's had trouble on special teams, especially with the punt, not an insignificant accomplishment, you say.
Yeah, I definitely think that's going to solidify him as the starting punt returner here for South Florida. JB, when you're evaluating these positions, when you're trying to identify, you know, guys that you can utilize to help you win games, a key component of that is trust. You know, and here Terrence Mitchell is, his first game ever in college. It's in Tampa, where he grew up. You know, he's been itching to get a return. Two of them kicked out of bounds. He finally gets one that's kicked to him. And the smart thing to do is fair catch, and that's exactly what he did. You know, Coach Holtz will look at that and say, you know what, for a man that's only 18, we feel like we can trust him. We know he has the ability, but we feel like he's going to do the right thing, and that's big.
Speaking of doing the right thing, how about Marcus Shaw doing all of them, going the distance, touchdown, USF, 64 yards for the freshman. I think Coach Holtz has some gems, and Marcus Shaw may be one of them. Watch the burst.
All the friends and family down in Arcadia, Florida have to be excited. The DeSoto High School product, quick through the hole, elusive at the point of contact, and explodes to the end zone. You know, all the attributes that you look for in a great running back were on display by the freshman.
Schwartz on one more time for another point after. This one is true, and it's 59-14. So the Bulls strike again. Marcus Shaw, playing in his first collegiate game, takes it to the house on Bright House Sports Network. Welcome back, Bulls fans. For all the latest information on your team, check out www.gousfbulls.com. The official website of USF Athletics has all the latest stories and stats and plenty of audio and video highlights as well. For all things USF Athletics, go to the source, www.gousfbulls.com. And while the team was over in Vero Beach for training camp, I was there almost every day. The daily updates from Amy Woodruff and crew were phenomenal. Some of the behind-the-scenes stuff, the egg tosses, the talent show, just really good stuff on GoUSFBulls.com. A touchback on the kick for USF. They have a 59-14 lead in part because of the play on the defensive side of the ball, creating turnovers on interceptions. Mike Linares gets it started, and it really became contagious tonight, Sean.
And very opportunistic defense tonight. Took advantage of some Stony Brook errors. But you want to be two things defensively, JB. That's aggressive and that's opportunistic. If you can be those two things, then the sky's the limit. So with the question marks that they had, losing four members of that unit to the National Football League, this is a great start to the 2010 season.
Stony Brook back on the field from their own 20. Miguel Masonette the running back. And since they took a 14-7 lead, the USF defense has been pitching a shutout. Masonette piled up at the line of scrimmage. Anthony Hill got his hands wrapped around him. Called a gain of 1.5.
And Skip Holtz is getting his message across to this ball club. You know, effort is something that's contagious. And, you know, with a 59-14 lead in the fourth quarter, only 4 minutes left, on a run right up the middle of the defense, 9 of the 11 South Florida defenders in on the tackle.
Great point. Sure, Coach Holtz appreciates it. Inside of 4 minutes to play now in the opener. Coulter on second down and 8. It's Masonette again. Not much there on the running game. That's been the case all night. I think it all starts with stopping the run. The Bulls have done just that. And then you force Coulter into those uncomfortable passing situations and the interceptions we saw. The montage there is exactly what happens.
And the Stony Brook team, you know, they're built around, you know, Edwin Goins and that running attack. Anytime you keep them in third and long the entire game, you know, this offense just not built for that. And you have to take your hat off to USF. They came in, they did what they're supposed to do. They have a comfortable lead. They're going to go into Gainesville next week undefeated to play Urban Meyer and the Gators. And I know that upset is on their mind.
Chris McMillan makes the catch there to move the chains as the clock continues to run at 3 minutes. Certainly the players that were here for the upset in Tallahassee will go in with the same mindset, and those who are new to the squad getting some valuable playing time and a chance to build confidence here today. And that will be a noon kickoff in Gainesville in the heat of the swamp, so the depth they're developing will be critical next week. Substitution heavy game. Again, Masonette on the carry. Finds some running room as he cuts back to his left. A gain of 9 on first down. Set up second and short. Jaquiz Jenkins makes the tackle.
And you see Dontavia Bogan, you know, throwing up the Bulls. Signing, he's got to be ecstatic. Here he is, a senior coming into his last year. You know, not a lot of people, you know, probably know who he is on a national level. And this is a start to what hopefully for him is going to be a magnificent senior campaign.
Let's go, second and short for the Seawolves. Steady diet of Masonette here. He works his way up through the middle near midfield. It will be a first down. Speaking of Dontavia Bogan, why don't we give you our CGM Services coolest play of the game. And for USF, it was their first one offensively. 59 yards. Dontavia Bogan off to the races.
And sometimes you don't need the entree, just the appetizer. Then you tell the server, check, please.
And tip as you get to the end zone. Should mention the Bulls with 59 points. Tying a team game high from 2009 against CSU. Here, Curtis Weatherspoon announced as the tackler there. He's had a nice game as a reserve linebacker. Good pursuit of the football. As Coach Holtz watches the final minute tick away. And a good start to his era, Sean King, wouldn't you say?
Oh, definitely. You couldn't ask for more. Outside of the special teams turnovers, you know, you got to be pleased with everything else that occurred tonight.
Could be the final play from scrimmage here. Jakulski running left side. I'm sure the Bulls would like to wrap him up and would prefer not to allow any last points. Good game by Jakulski. To the 27, Joyce, the freshman, saving a potential touchdown. The clock resumes. We'll have 18 seconds to go here. Jakulski again on the carry. Jenkins up from the safety spot to make the tackle along with Claude Davis, reserve defensive end. And that will do it. Skip Holtz gets a win in his first start at USF, 59-14. The Bulls rally from down a touchdown in the first quarter in impressive fashion, do not allow points the rest of the way. The defense really locked down. B.J. Daniels took command. And we'll take a break right here. But when we come back, a post-game interview with Coach Holtz, Victoria Lim on the sidelines, 59-14. Back with more after this.
Welcome back. USF beat Stony Brook 59-14. Standing with me right now is the victorious coach, Skip Holtz. What's it like to get this first game under your belt?
It's nice to get that first victory. There were a lot of positive things in this game. There were a lot of mistakes made, a lot of jitters, a lot of young guys out on this field for the first time. So it's great to get the first one out of the way, but just really proud of the way the players competed.
After knowing some of the mistakes, some of the struggles that Florida had, do you think that you're ready to face them next week?
Florida's got one of the best programs in the country, and I got a lot of respect for Urban Meyer and the great job that he's done there. And it'll be a great challenge for us. We're looking forward to going to Gainesville next week.
All right, thanks, Coach. Congratulations.
Thank you very much. Right. Appreciate it.
Guys, back to you.
And Victoria, thank you for all your hard work on the sideline tonight. Sean King, we'll get your final thoughts.
Well, I thought an impressive performance by University of South Florida. You know, I was surprised by the amount of depth that they have. You know, a lot of wide receivers stepped up tonight outside of just Bogan and Landy. Bravo Brown, Lamar stepped up. The running back position. You know, they're five deep. I think they can utilize these athletes as they move forward. And, you know, maybe a Big East championship in Skip Holtz's first year here is not that far out of reach.
As a former quarterback yourself, of course, we wanted to get your thoughts on B.J. Daniels coming in. And certainly as we go out as well, your evaluation of his performance tonight.
Outstanding. He had an unbelievable game. You know, coming into the game, I said that the one thing that he did this offseason is learn how to be Clark Kent. Everybody knows he's Superman. He did a good job of running this offense. Check down when he's supposed to check down. Went downfield and was aggressive when he needed to. Turned into Superman when he had to. I was really, really impressed by the maturation of the young man. I think he's going to have an unbelievable campaign this season.
Let's take a look at his campaign. We mentioned a trip to Gainesville next to take on the Gators. They struggled a little bit with Miami of Ohio, and before we leave, I want to get your thoughts on that. But here is the upcoming schedule, and we will have the next two home games available for you right here on Bright House Sports Network against Western Kentucky and FAU. And then the home opener against Syracuse as we get in to Big East play. And the Bulls do have the advantage of the unbalanced schedule in the Big East in their favor. They will get the majority of home games here. And especially late in the season, one thing to point out there, they only have to leave state borders once in the month of November. So a favorable schedule down the stretch. It will not be easy, of course, against Big East that is wide open. But how about the trip to Gainesville next? We're finishing with some thoughts there after both of us watched the Gators and the Bulls today. The Gators obviously struggled. The Bulls shook off some rust against lesser competition. What do you see next week?
Yeah, offensively, Florida struggled tremendously, but defensively, they're as good as ever. They lost a lot of guys, just like South Florida's National Football League, but they are back. They're really good. If South Florida can clean up their special teams, I think they can get this game into the fourth quarter. If they do that with B.J. Daniels at quarterback, you never know.
And we'll finish with some final highlights here. A new system at USF with Todd Fitch running the show. Any differences you observed, either with B.J. Daniels or the way the offense was run on the whole, I think a pretty plain vanilla scheme at the outset, not wanting to show too much.
But I like the offensive execution from start to finish. I thought they did a good job, no matter who was in the game, of creating positive plays offensively. And, you know, you can never go broke taking a profit. You know, that's my motto on offense. And tonight you saw them. Sometimes it was a short pass. Sometimes it was a deep pass. And they got the job done. Defensively, so many players played so well, created a lot of turnovers. If that's something they can carry over to next week, they'll have a chance. And what about the freshman? Matt Joyce on the pick, Shaw on the long touchdown run. The future is very bright for this South Florida program.
And Bobby Evild as well in relief. The backup quarterback job, hopefully you don't have to see too much of it this season, obviously, but in situations like this and going forward, should something happen to B.J. Daniels, Bobby Evild got some very valuable playing time.
Which one of those things, you never want to use it, but if you do, you hope that it's something that you can depend upon. And I think Bobby Evild, you know, did a very nice job in his first game tonight. Very proud of the young man. Thought he was efficient. Thought he was accurate. Led a couple touchdown drives. And that's all you want from your backup when he gets the opportunity to play.
All right, Sean, thank you very much. Pleasure working with you.
Thank
and we look
JB.
Forward to – another home game here in a couple of weeks, working together on Bright House Sports Network. For our producer, Chris McCulley, our director has been Bob Herman. A special thanks to Jeremy Sharp and Amy Woodruff and the entire USF communications staff preparing us for this ball game. For Sean King and Victoria Lim on the sideline, I'm J.B. Long. Good night from Tampa. Your final score, USF 59, Stony Brook 14.